always staying center. When push comes to shove, third eye wide open and dancing to music, accepting a power, knowing how to use it. Coming together, we circle the globe, seeing the oneness, our chakras are glowing. Our vibrations where we want it to be, keep it high, you know how it feels to be free. All you gotta do to understand these ways, breathe real deep and enjoy each day. Work selflessly with others and we'll also have together. Tomorrow's now and there's beautiful weather, so breathe. Breathe in the air. Yeah, take a deep breath. It's everywhere. Heal my spirit. Heal my body. Heal my soul. Oh, I know who I am. Consciousness spinning.
Winter of 1964 came this movie to Jamaica. The Skatalites took the music from the movie, put it to the ska, and came up with this sound. It's called Ba! 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 The Guns of Navarone.
Lorenzo Navarone for you from the Scottalites for the High Bop Ska album. Thank you for joining us. This is a recorded version of Lake County Magazine. Technical issues keep plaguing us. What's up with that?
We're jinxed.
No, don't say that. We're blessed. We're totally blessed. How could you even think we are jinxed? Are you gonna, did you flip it? Oh, you're still a little trapped? Do you want me to try to stretch you out?
No, I'm good.
Okay. Yeah,
stretch
folks, sorry to say, there was an upgrade done on the hosting website, and ever since they've done the upgrade, we have not been able to get our stream connected back to them.
Yeah, they've changed the server, and the IP address has changed, and every time I talk to the owner of the streaming channel, they it should work.
Yeah, exactly. Whereas tech support for our equipment says our side is working too. And so nobody wants to take responsibility for the problem.
Right. So I'm going to work on a secondary stream site for this coming week and see if we can resolve some of the issues here.
Right.
So
hopefully we'll be live. We may be streaming from another location, but it'll all go back to lcm-tv.com. So we should be able to have you enjoy our presence there.
Absolutely. So
we're both sick. And I want to thank Mark for filling in for me last week because Peter would not let me come in, even though I probably could have. But I would have, hacked your head off.
Yeah, even though he did hog the show.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Well, he's not shy.
No, he's not.
Yes. So that's one good thing.
Actually, I'm just joking. He did a hell of a job.
He did. It was a good show.
Very good interacting with the guests.
Well, we had really good guests last week, too. You can watch that on lakomagazine.com. The recording of last week's show is available for viewing.
Yeah,
so,
it is.
Yeah. So until the other one comes up, then you can watch that. How's that?
Sounds good to me.
Yeah. So.
It's brisk out this morning.
It's flipping cold.
And by the way, folks, if you hear a little meow in the background, we have our little 18-year-old kitty cat here by the name of Flash.
Going to see the vet for the first time in a long time.
Yeah.
He's been nice and healthy, and he still is, but he's 18. And we just lost his brother, 18-year-old, also. So we're really just getting him his checkup as an old man. Because we're all getting so old.
Watch the old man stuff.
Speaking of old man, you turned another year yesterday.
Yesterday. Monday.
Monday.
Tuesday. What's today?
Monday. It was Monday. Because today's the 4th.
Yep. It turned a young age of 63.
Yes.
You'd never know it, would you?
You're looking good for 63. Yeah.
We actually went to the doctor yesterday, and he he said, "Why are you here?" I'm like, "I don't know, because my wife told me." And he checked all my vital signs and me and said, "You're in good shape. Get the hell out of here." So that made me feel good, except for the seizures and the prostate and the high blood pressure. Other than that, I'm just great. And you, on the other hand.
Yeah, my diabetes is out of control, so that's not very good.
You got to deal with that.
And we really didn't do much for your birthday, so we're going to celebrate it on Saturday.
Ah, yes. We have a barbecue in the afternoon.
Yes, at our friend Sandy's house. That's going to be fun.
And then we're going to the American Legion?
Yeah, to the crab feed.
Yes.
You can eat crab.
Yeah.
Can't think of a better way to spend your birthday. Then we're going to top it off with a little trip up to the Riviera Hills Country Club.
Yeah, we're going to see Pat Gleason and his...
And Blue 62.
Yep. And
of course, his wife, Joni, has a show here every Monday afternoon.
A Positive Light.
A Positive Light. And you can watch the replays of that where? Since we haven't streamed.
LCM TV.
Okay, good. So they're posted up there.
Yep.
Okay, excellent. Okay. And we also have another new show, really interesting show. A gentleman who originally is from Haiti and lives in Canada is doing a Skype show. And right now we're not able to record the actual Skype. But we're doing it as a radio show with pictures that he's sending us. And until we can figure out how to get the Skype up on our equipment.
Actually, remind me.
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
Okay. And the cool thing is that he interviews people all around the world. He's done two shows now, which I hope to have finished editing by tomorrow. And the first show was with the partner, the group he's with is called Pasha. And that is a group that advocates for the handicapped in Haiti. And so he interviewed his partner there, who is heavily involved in the environment there. And they did a really interesting presentation on the destruction of the forests in Haiti and the consequences of that, people just taking down trees for charcoal, and how it's not just Haitians that are doing it. Also, the people of the Dominican Republic are crossing over the border and taking the trees from Haiti. And Haiti's almost completely denuded anyway. And Dominican Republic is a very nice, lush part of the island of Hispaniola. So it's a pretty drastic situation there. It's, I don't know why you're laughing.
I'm sorry, folks, if you see me laughing because I'm watching my kitty cat just wander around the office.
He doesn't know what's going on. It's first time over here. So.
Yeah.
So anyway, that was very interesting. The second interview that he did, which was over the weekend, was with a doctor in Brazil, and they were talking about health and what you can do with food to keep your health good and all that kind of stuff. So very interesting topics and very interesting people, and it's truly a global program. I'm really excited to have it on our network. It's going to be a lot
of
fun.
And I'm going to downline some software. Which
downline?
Downline? Downline the software. Don't make fun of me.
I got to.
Download some software which allow us to see the Skype video on camera and all that good stuff. So we're working on that,
okay,
too. So
yeah.
I have nothing better to do just because it's tax season.
Okay.
Yeah. On that note.
So what else was new?
We went out to see Hippie Joe on Sunday.
Oh, yeah.
We want to talk about that.
Did a site visit for the new Fire in the Barn concert that will be happening on July 4th weekend. This is going to be great. If you like reggae, you are going to have a blast. The guy has a 300-acre ranch up there on Elk Mountain Road. And last year they had a one-day festival. They got almost 1,000 people in one day. And we're hoping to double that with the three-day festival. But we have some great entertainers. We have, if you're familiar with reggae, Sister Carol, President Brown, who played last year. We have Pato Banton. We have Gorilla Takeover Sound System. Also, Rocker T Sound System will be there, too. A lot of local groups, including Righteous Vibrations and Without a Net, and regional groups out of the Bay Area. Let me pull up my list here. So we have Clan Dykin is also going to be there all 3 days with their Pedal Power stage.
Pedal Power. Sorry, that's cute.
Mendo Dope is going to be there. Trevor Lyon. We're trying to get Roots Underground. We're trying to get Michael Rose. And if they come in, they'll be the two headliners for the Friday and Saturday night.
Right.
And Pato's the headliner for Sunday.
And I'm going to add my 2 cents.
Also, Black Slate from England. Midnight Sun. Higher Logic. Dub Highway. Skunk Funk. Let's see, Empress Unification and the Fire Squad Band. That's a group of women that sing in Farsi, which is the language of Iraq or Iran, I'm not sure. They also have an Asian singer and an African singer. I mean, it's great. Four beautiful women, and they all come on there and just do nothing but roots and culture music.
Oh, that could draw a lot of people.
Yeah.
Just four beautiful ladies.
Yeah,
it's
pretty
hot.
Exactly. Now, what were your two? Oh, and Ione Angeles is the last one that we've got confirmed so far.
No, I'm just going to reiterate what I've said many times on the show, is that if you've never seen Pato Banton, you got to come out and see him.
He is
awesome.
Great show.
I mean, he's a good singer. His band is great. But just the overall performance, it's a performance, not just music. It's great.
Yeah, I mean, he comes with a horn section. And, you know, they've got
Yeah, but the way
everything.
He performs.
And he's just such a good performer.
Exactly. That's what I like.
He's very engaging with the audience is what I like. And most people that come to see him know him and know all of his songs. And so you find people who he puts on the microphone and they sing along with him. It's just a lot of fun.
I thought he was married.
He is.
Well, you told me he was engaging.
Oh, God. Somebody help me.
Hey, someone has to have
somebody
a little.
Somebody help me.
Got to have a little bit of
you
humor.
Call that a sense of humor?
Well, it's my dad's.
Yeah, I see that.
Yes.
Unfortunately, it's a lot like my dad's, too.
Yes. What can I tell you? So,
I know.
Anyway.
Sick people.
Hey, I've been called a lot of things, but...
You've been called sick.
That's true.
And anyway. Right now you are sick. As you cough in my ear, thank you very
I'm
much.
I'm sorry. But I feel good, though. I don't feel
That's
bad.
That's good. Yeah, yeah, I feel
Unlike
good, too,
Monday, where
for
I was
my cough.
A miserable SOB.
Yeah, it doesn't, you know, it seems like it's a short-term. A lot of people, it's not going away, but with us, it seems like it's going to be a short-term.
Which is, yeah, that's because we eat healthy.
We try.
And we stay healthy.
We try. Yes. And no GMOs, by the way.
That's correct. Yes. Absolutely.
We are a GMO-free family.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell that to our kitties and puppy.
Yes.
Speaking of puppy, our beautiful studio dog, Sydney, has been to the vet twice this week.
Yes. Oh, that was another adventure. Yesterday, I had to take her to Santa Rosa.
You know, folks, I don't know about you, but when surgery on an animal is more expensive than a human being,
it's pretty
we're
sad
something
state
wrong
of affairs.
Here.
Yeah.
Even X-rays are more expensive than humans.
And I don't understand what the reasoning is. You know, it doesn't make sense.
Because they know there's no such thing as real pet insurance, so they can charge whatever they want.
Exactly. So what happened was she got surgery back in December. Those of you that follow us will remember this. And she had an abscess, and they put in a couple of pipes, and they drained it out and put her on antibiotics, and she seemed to be okay. And then about 3 weeks ago, it started coming back in the same spot. And we were fortunate enough. Peter really was diligent in getting a hot compresses on her, on this part of this wound. And right where she had the first incision, it decided to explode. That was Monday? That was your birthday present,
yeah, Monday
right?
morning. Oh,
and you want to talk about horrible. Two
oh
cups
God.
Of fluid came out of her that was the color of Day-Glow green mixed with milk. And it was pretty horrible. So it flowed out, and at that point, we contacted our local vet, and they recommended we take her down to the vet in Santa Rosa, which is a surgeon, and have the wound opened because it could be a foxtail in there,
right.
And foxtails are really deadly. So we don't really know still what it is because, unfortunately, we can't afford the surgery. So they have put us on kept her on antibiotics, and we're just going to keep her on the antibiotics.
Tell them how much they wanted for surgery.
Yeah, they wanted between $2,500 and $3,500. And they have to make an incision that's going to be about 18 inches long along her side in order to try to find this thing. And it's pretty scary. So we want to just treat her with the antibiotics for now, raise the money for the surgery, and then take her down and get it taken care of. And the doctor seems fairly confident that he'll find something there somewhere above her rib cage. So
yeah,
it's just really frightening.
It is. Yeah. We love our puppy so much.
Yeah.
She's such a great puppy.
So today is, hey, Flash. Let's get Flash up here.
Oh, gosh.
Hey, buddy.
Come on, Flashy. I call him B&W for obvious reasons here.
Hello. You say
Make
hi
sure.
to
there
everybody?
He is.
Hi, Flashy.
Meet B&W.
He's 18 years old, and he thinks he's a teenager. He's also a pothead.
Yeah, he is a pothead, folks.
He loves the green, hold on, the green water leaves from the pot plants. And he eats those dry or fresh. And I believe that's what has kept him in such good health because, as you may be able to tell, come here, buddy.
Come on, Flashy, Flashy.
As you
come
may
on.
Be able to tell, he's in pretty good shape for an old man. Hi, sweetie. Hi. How's my butt?
No, you can't have my coffee.
Hello. You going to hang out with us a little? He's a little confused. He's never been to the office. Yeah. But he's my little love muffin.
He
he's
likes to...
he's my tuxedo kitty.
Yeah, he likes to wander,
yeah.
Especially on people's desks and
paperwork.
He's
very talkative, so you're probably going to hear him meowing over the course of the next couple of hours. But, oh, you keep getting caught in
yeah,
the tablecloth. Yeah. What's up, Flash? You going to hang out with us? Hi. Aw, that's good. He's a happy boy. He's purring really loud, too. He gets this loud purr when he's happy.
Yes, absolutely. He's a good
Let's
kitty.
See if we can pick up your purr.
All right, let's continue. Don't get distracted. You're going to make me have to do all the talking then. I did that last
Aww,
week.
Poor baby.
So, anyway, Flash is a great cat.
Yeah,
just unfortunately
he's one of our
said
best.
He came to our family just about 3 months prior to Milo, who passed.
Just last week.
And
they
were best buds. They always hung out together. Yeah. And
since they're the same age, we're going to get him his old man check up, make sure everything's good. Aw, you're happy now, huh?
So
he was a little confused when he first got here. Now he looks like he's doing good.
If you can't tell, folks, we're kind of like animal lovers.
Like to the maximum.
And be honest with you, I get along with kitties and puppies a hell of a lot better than I do humans. So no offense to you guys out there who actually know me, and we're kind of sort of acquaintances, but sorry.
But if they know you, they know that's true.
They know that. Everyone knows that.
Wow, he's having a blast. That's good.
He is. That's good.
Starting to relax.
Yeah, so.
He was a little upset when he first got here.
Well, yeah, I put him in the back of the Jeep in his container, and I was trying to take the turns and the corners as slowly as I can, but I think he must have lost his footing and smashed his nose.
He got hurt on the way.
But he's fine now.
Yeah, as you could tell, he's not suffering now.
So.
Oh, Flash.
Anyhow, if we get back on subject a bit. So, Fire in the Barn, July 4th weekend, three-day event.
So exciting. I'm just
Can
I'm
we
like
start
stoked.
Talking about pricing?
Yeah, ticket prices are pretty easy. They're $50 a day for the whole day. And each day, well, Friday starts at 4, but the other 2 days start at noon, and they both go to about midnight. So you get 12 hours of entertainment for that. And we will have a large number of vendors. We're going to have, lots of good types of food, a good variety of food. We're going to have,
we're gonna have
a lot of good cultural entertainment. Let's
right.
just put it
and
down.
We'll also have other vendors.
Oh, good job. Would you stop?
No, he knocked it off. He knocked it over.
I will take care of my coffee. You take care of yours.
Fine.
Okay?
Be that way.
Thank you.
Anyway, we're going to have lots of different vendors there along with the food vendors. It's also $150 for the weekend, including parking
and parking.
Right.
Yeah.
So
that's a good deal for the 3 days.
And
it's pretty self-contained. There's going to be, it's 300 acres. There's a river there. You could swim in.
Right.
He says there will be water there in July.
He promises.
Yes.
So it's and the stage is going to be the stage and the and sound equipment is as professional as you can get. We have a professional
engineer. Great system. What we got is a Mack truck semi trailer that comes in. The stage comes out of the semi and sets right up in front of where the semi is. And then the semi turns into the green room and the backstage area. And it's got two restrooms with showers and the whole shebang. So it's going to be awesome. And it comes all self-contained, sound, lights, and stage all in one
package.
And
a green room for the entertainers. Yeah, this is
awesome.
Yeah.
So we're real excited about that. And our engineer is Paul Carlson. He's a well-known sound engineer in the Bay Area and has worked with a lot of big bands. Yeah. And
so this is not going to be a little local yokel event. This is going to be
a big time
event. And Hippie Joe is going all out to make it as professional as he can.
Yep.
And hopefully we have a good turnout, which allows this to be an annual event.
Exactly.
And the proceeds, folks, after reimbursements of all the cost, is actually going to be mostly going to nonprofits.
Well, we can specify what kind
Go ahead.
Of nonprofits. We're actually using a portion of the money to build the new Cobb Mountain radio station.
Yep.
And that will pay for the antenna and the transmitter. And then the rest of the money will be used to build a youth center in the north part of Lake County.
Right.
So it's very exciting. We're really happy. There'll be a 215 lounge there. We're going to have all kinds of fun things for people to do and the kids and everything. So please come out and join us for 4th of July weekend. We might not be able to do fireworks because of the fire restrictions, but who needs fireworks when you got reggae music? That's what I was saying.
I was hoping for one or two classic rock bands, but I was voted down.
Well, without Annette's in there, you know.
Yeah.
Klondike is pretty rocky, too.
I was thinking more about Santana. And
next year. Willie Nelson and Santana are coming next year.
That would be nice. So, and folks out there, if you have your own business and it may be conducive, you can give us a shout and arrange for you to have a vendor booth. Pricing is reasonably fair for
the three days.
So have any questions, give us a shout. 701-641-6 for the festival news. And if you, since we're recorded, can't really call into the show today, but that's usually 701-6029. So Flashy, you really
you're
the character.
Yeah.
By the way, he likes to give you love bites, and every now and then I get tooth marks in my hand.
I got one in my hand right now.
So anyway, so said Sunday we went out there, and you don't realize how beautiful it is out in the Upper Lake area in Hippie Joe's area, because we were
in
looking
the cow pasture.
Yeah.
With the cows.
He has black Angus cows, and they literally followed us everywhere we went. And they're like,
he does
hey,
not
guys,
slaughter them.
You got food? Food?
Yeah, they're so cute.
Yeah, they were cute.
Yeah.
And he has an Australian shepherd hanging out.
Oh, yeah.
With one blue
he's
eye.
He's got a couple of really cool dogs.
Yeah, he does. So, anyway.
Oh, and he's got those wolf dogs.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But anyway, they're friendly.
Crazy.
He just doesn't. They don't like cattle, though. But anyway, it's just a beautiful setting with the surrounded by the mountains and the river. It's just an absolutely beautiful setting. He's going to be putting some tents up in case it gets awfully hot for July 4th weekend. So this is going to be a really tremendous event. And you know something? It's something Lake County needs. It's going to generate a lot of revenues for the different nonprofits. It's going to attract people to Lake County so they can see the beauty of this area. And hopefully we get full cooperation from the necessary government agencies and the sheriff's department, fire department, forest department, and make this an annual event and start creating some activity and some interest in this county. And that's what we need here, folks. Because, you know, even though most of the people there are going to be volunteers, we are going to be paying some people. We're going to create some part-time jobs initially.
It'll be an annual event.
And you just don't know what comes out of this type of event. So...
It's true. Plus the impact on the surrounding areas.
Oh, absolutely.
People go buy groceries for the weekend to camp out.
People may stay at some of the guest lodges or little motels around the place who don't like camping, like I'm too old. So we'll see what happens. But it's going to be interesting to track the cash flow coming into the economy. And we can talk to some of the local businesses, especially up in Upper Lake, and see what type of impact this has. And that's what this is all about, is trying to generate revenues, not just for the nonprofits and for Joe just to want to do this for the community, but to also see how the economic impact is on the local businesses. Hey, I'm going to get on a rant here. I don't want to.
No, now. It's very important. And something that on this scale can bring in, you know, a good 2,000 or 3,000 people easily.
Well, what I was going to do is contact, which I still have to do, folks. I make a lot of promises. Eventually I do fulfill them, is get hold of the economic development
yeah.
department and say, hey, this is what's happening on this weekend. Why don't you start sending some surveys out to some of the local business people and track the impact on the event.
Good idea.
So I'll do that. I gotta start making notes. I'm gonna put that at the bottom.
Well,
here.
We might have some is that line one or two?
Okay,
let it go.
It's probably Travis.
Yeah, exactly. we have one client that calls every day, three times a day.
Well, he's also becoming a good friend. He's also now on my baseball team.
Yes,
and
that's another thing.
Yeah, he's a lonely. He's
a
really
man.
Nice gentleman.
Travis,
and he lost his puppy last
yes.
year after 16-odd years.
No flash.
And no, you can't go up there.
Let him explore.
All right, so.
Hey, he's feeling happy. Yeah. That's a good thing.
So as my wife is distracted here, just want you folks to know that I have 5 weeks until baseball season.
Oh, boy. Now we're in the countdown phase.
April 12th is opening day. And this Sunday we have the league tryouts down at A Place to Play down in Santa Rosa, just off Highway 12.
So if anybody out there wants a tryout, there is some kind of carpooling if you get on Peter's team.
Yes. And we've added four new players this year, which is going to give us a lot of depth on our roster. And we're going to be very competitive this year. And I have an attitude problem where I'm going to kick butt one way or another. And so anyone who's interested in trying out, it's all age groups. But if you're 55 or actually 53 and older, because we get some leeway there, come on down. You can either join my team or actually just go to the tryouts and get selected by in a draft order. We have the number 3 draft pick today, this year.
Really?
Yes.
Well, you know what that means. You did crappy last year.
No. Well, yeah. We did bad because we had no depth in our roster. Between family commitments,
yes.
You know, these damn wives are always taking husbands off the baseball field, and injuries, we really...
Oh, it's all the wives' fault now? Oh, please.
We at the last third of the season, we were playing with 11 players, and except for me, most of my guys get tired after 3 or 4 innings. We need to rotate people in and out. That's why having roster depth is so important this year, because everyone has about equal talent on the team, but they just get tired. I don't understand that. I never get tired.
They're old, okay? You're
what am
not
I?
Old.
I, You know what it is, folks? Is
you have the power of the
mind.
I
love being on a baseball field and being a pitcher, and my ego there, I refuse to get myself off the field. I think I'm the best guy there, therefore it's hard for me to give the ball up to somebody else.
What do you think? That's a bunch of bull or what?
Whatever. So anyway, 5 weeks to baseball this Sunday, opening day.
Yay.
And I know, like the last several years, we always, the first two games of the year are always against the best teams in the division. I think they do that on purpose. So anyhow, breaking news, folks, since we're just rambling as usual, the Supreme Court is hearing, as we sit here speaking to you on a recorded basis, are discussing the legality of the Affordable Care Act, and specifically in regards to those states that do not have their own individual website providing the health care to the masses. And I think it's 17 states do have their own state website, and therefore those people who apply, like i.e. California, coveredcalifornia.ca.gov, whatever, we get, for better choice of words, subsidized premiums if you qualify for that. And that's by choosing either your own insurance or going through the bronze, silver, or platinum plans, or depending upon income, even being referred to Medi-Cal under Affordable Care Act. But those states who do not have state websites, I can give an example, Arizona, they refuse, which is typical of Arizona, to cooperate with the Affordable Care Act. So those individuals in that state have to go through the federal website. Well, if you go through the federal website, you don't get subsidized premiums. So the Supreme Court is hearing a ruling to find out if that's fair, if they can still become eligible for the subsidized premiums, or Obamacare goes away. So right now, based on the news release from the New York Times, there's some very heavy discussions going on. And it's obviously the liberal Supreme Court judges are saying, nah, Obamacare is cool. We just leave it like it is. The more conservative judges are saying, no, this is unfair. We need to revise the situation. Both sides are saying it really depends upon the reading and interpretation of the Affordable Care Act. And then the Chief Justice right now is not saying anything. Hmm. So it's really a very divided court right now, and no one really knows which way they're going to swing. And for those here in California, the only way we can be affected is they just get rid of the Affordable Care Act, which would just cause total chaos right now in the health insurance industry, along with those who are getting subsidized assistance now. And if they lose that, a lot of people can't afford health insurance. I know for us, it's going to cost almost $1,000 a month. That's ridiculous. And those states who do not have the State Care Act, they will either benefit by being allowed to be subsidized, or they're going to have nothing. So it's a very interesting. What are you playing with? Never mind. So even though this may sound boring to some of you, this is an extremely important court case, and it really will have a major impact on the health insurance industry and us in general. So I'm going to be paying attention to that pretty closely and keep you guys updated on that. What else is going on?
Well, we got the issue in Clear Lake.
Well, that's hang on that 1 minute.
Okay.
That's going to be a very lengthy one.
Yes.
The other folks, I just got I subscribe to a lot of accounting / business / economic newsletters online. And they just announced that due to the cutbacks and staff shortages within the IRS, and they basically have a hiring freeze right now, which is kind of good too, for auditing purposes, that they're saying that business owners are going to have a lot less audits being initiated because of the reduction of staff. However, there's a little caveat to that. They define small businesses as corporations, small S corporations, limited liability companies, limited partnerships. Those what they consider small business. Even though everyone here, the corporations, the 1%ers, we're talking about individual family-owned businesses or people who started their own business and their accountants have told them to become a corporation or whatever. Those individuals or those businesses are going to have a less chance of being audited now than ever before. So if you guys are in business and you're operating as a sole proprietorship, you may want to change. Less chance of getting audited. Isn't that a good thing?
Yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I thought so. So.
Okay. So let's see what else is new.
My computer just froze.
What's up, there we go.
The other thing is, since my wife is hesitating here, is that the audit results for the last for 2013, not 2014 yet, 2013 showed that personal audits were at the lowest percentage ever.
Really?
It was less than 0.8% of all individuals that filed tax returns in this country were audited. So that's good news. So the budgetary restraints and trying to balance the budget and all that good stuff has really hurt the IRS from an auditing point of view. Even though that's their most critical department, they try not to cut staff there. They've had no choice. The major impact of the cutbacks on the IRS is customer service. Trying to get through on their 800 phone number for a simple question or an answer, forget it. You're going to be on hold for hours and hours and hours. So if you have questions regarding the situation with taxes or whatever, I advise you go to a tax professional because they have a special 800 hotline they can call, and they get through a little bit faster than most people do. So, what are you reading?
A bunch of stuff about Chase. J.P. Morgan Chase has been ordered to pay $50 million to homeowners in a settlement with the U.S. Department of Justice.
Yeah, how much is that going to get?
That was for robo-signing.
Oh, really?
Yep.
What state was that done in?
That was a federal case.
Oh, Larry Anderson said
yeah.
that. Cool. Thanks, Larry.
So it's a federal case, so I guess it's all the people that got screwed over. And then he has several stories about death by foreclosure, denied six times for loan mod. Man kills wife and self and burns down home.
Oh, geez.
67-year-old man dies after collapsing in court after a foreclosure hearing. Foreclosure sale, man shoots terminally ill wife.
Flash, you can't see senior.
Stress of losing home, another fiery suicide. Just sad. What's you know, this whole thing of people's homes being taken away.
Yeah.
Then we got another notice from one of our contacts regarding a woman's house that was actually razed completely to the ground by the county this week.
This week?
This
by
week
the county?
This, yeah.
Oh. Of Lake?
Yes. Oh Lake boy. County Courts. She filed a complaint against them. It was Lake County Community Development was planning to demolish the house on your birthday.
Nice.
And
of them.
I guess she filed a lawsuit.
I assume it was red tagged.
Probably.
Yeah.
And I'm pulling it up now just to see if I couldn't get it to open before, so I don't know why this document just doesn't like to open.
Yeah, some of them don't.
Yeah. So anyway, there is a lawsuit that this woman filed. Her name is Jay Fontaine. And they are looking at trying to, I guess they put a stop to the demolition.
Well, that's good. Well, I got a temporary stop order. That's good.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah,
this whole
know,
thing
this
is.
That's what I'm afraid is going to happen in Clear Lake. And, of course, they say, oh, no, we'll never take anybody's home for
yeah.
pot. But that's not the way the ordinance is written.
No. Why don't we talk about that at the 10 o'clock hour?
Okay.
We've got a few minutes left. So.
If you like.
A way we can get really into
well,
it in depth
okay.
and stuff.
Then do that.
But we can
that's
do that.
I don't
okay.
care.
I'm sorry. I don't mean
there's not that much to talk about.
Well, I got a couple of things
okay.
here. So, yeah, folks. I Wednesday, Tuesday. What's today? Wednesday.
Today's Wednesday.
Tuesday night. I usually kind of put my notes together. I know.
Gee, you're so hairy.
Put my notes together for today's talk show, and I sometimes have a lot to talk about. Sometimes I have nothing to talk about, but. What I do every Tuesday evening, if I don't have an opportunity to listen to the BOS meeting Tuesday mornings, which this time of year is kind of difficult for me, I go through the agenda. Sometimes the video is up. Sometimes it's not by Tuesday evening. We're at the whim of the IT department there, I think. But the last couple of weeks, the meetings have been pretty mundane, but a couple of things they talked about yesterday. Of course, if I get my computer worked, I can be more knowledgeable. But the first thing that just comes in mind where I don't need any notes is that a couple of weeks ago or last week, I can't remember, the Board of Supervisors voted 3-2 to support the state of Jefferson idea. And
the drunken smiley face.
Right. And, you know, in principle, it sounds like a good idea because we do not have the necessary representation in Sacramento. And the big cities down south seem to get most of the priorities. And we're just a rural agricultural area, and sometimes we just don't get the necessary aid and help. However, based on our own little investigation and research, it appears that the state of Jefferson is going to be an extremely right-wing conservative base, and that's
it
not...
It seems that way.
It
right
seems
now.
That way, and it doesn't seem that would do well for our specific needs here. They want to concentrate on deforestation, mining, things of that nature, which is not very environmentally conducive. So,
and, well, we know already that that side of the fence does not care about the environment.
Right, and of course the cannabis industry will go down the drain immediately, but that's another story. So anyway, my point of my subject here is that I didn't realize, and some of you may have, some of you may not have, that the vote 3-2, which was Mr. Brown, Mr. Comstock, and Mr. Smith.
And a lot of people think it was 4-1 because it was misreported that way. It was actually 3-2, we verified.
Right. And what transpired from that vote, which, again, I was not aware of until I saw the agenda yesterday, is that on the next election, they're putting a, I guess it's a referendum.
It's a referendum, yeah.
Okay, it's asking the public, do they want to separate from the state of California and become the state of Jefferson, or do they want to stay the same? So here the Board of Supervisors is going to spend money on putting this referendum on the ballot to find out if the citizens of Lake County really want to separate or not. And folks, you know, again, in theory it may sound good, but there's absolutely no information being shared by our board in regards to the economic impact, the separation, the government structure, how it's going to be paid for, how they're going to generate revenues, what type of expenses they're going to incur. And let's face it, with the counties that are concerned about possibly separating, they don't have a hell of a lot of population base. If you don't have a hell of a lot of population base, where are your tax revenues going to come from? How are you going to pay for all the services? How are you going to do health care? How are you going to do the welfare part of it through Medicaid and Medicare at the state level? How are you going to do unemployment? How are you going to do food stamps? This is extremely difficult, or it's a lot to implement from a staffing point of view. And I just don't know how these dollars are going to be generated. And this whole thing about separation, I don't think they've even seen the economic plan or the financial plan.
And we already
plan.
Know our supervisors are totally against cannabis as an industry.
Oh, we know
so
that.
What are the other guys going to say? I believe they're going to be against it too. I don't see any point in doing this. This is going to be pretty horrible.
Well, you know, it's one thing for the board speaking on their, by the way, folks, they're speaking on the for themselves, not the general public here. It's all right for them to say, yeah, 3-2, we decide that wouldn't be a bad idea. But to spend taxpayer money on putting a referendum on the ballot, I just don't get it right now. Because all it is, it's a talk of the town. There's no action taking place. There's nothing being filed with the state right now saying we want to be separated and have the Assembly and the Senate vote on it and then go to a public voting. But it's just talk right now. And the reality of it happening anyway is probably slim and none. So this is a waste of money right now. I don't get it. The other thing that came out of yesterday's meeting, which I found somewhat interesting, is that Lake County, or the County of Lake, and the union representing, quote-unquote, management employed by Lake County, i.e. staff, revise their contract. And what it states, I'm going to ad lib here, because my computer throws it, is that for the fiscal year 14 to 15, which means that the fiscal year for the county starts July 1st, ends June 30th, then plus for the year 15 and 16, the county has decided that management staff can, in lieu of their cost of living increase, or what they call COLA, they can take personal leave in lieu of. And usually the personal leave has to be taken prior to the end of the fiscal year. Otherwise, you lose it. Well, the county has now said, well, I'll tell you what, you're going to be allowed to roll it over, if you request that to happen, to the following year. So in lieu of their COLA increase, which would probably be, I don't know, 1% to 3% now, they get extra time off. And just, I can't tell exactly how many days it is per year based on the COLA increase, but it's quite substantial. I think if I remember correctly, it's up to 2 weeks additional leave. My point here is, you know, I have no problem with a negotiation between the union and the county to try to figure maybe more flexible to the employees. You know, I have no problem with that. When it was American Airlines, we had the same flex program. But the Board of Supervisors, in their way of doing conducting their business, has decided to take a week off every month. We've talked about this. They have having three meetings a month now instead of four. And this reason they stated was that staff was overworked and they wanted to accommodate staff so they could get their job done more efficiently and with better productivity. So they didn't have to come to the meetings. So that's why they decided to meet three times a week instead of four.
A month.
However, right. However, now they're turning around and saying, well, if you want to take more vacation or personal time, you can do that. So to me, that's a little bit contradictory. We're not going to meet 1 week a month now to save, to make our staff more productive. But in turn, they're saying, well, you can take up to 2 weeks off now instead of the COLA increase. So, yeah, the county saves some money by not having the increase, but these people take 2 weeks off with paid leave. So, to me, they're getting the same compensation by not taking leave, being paid, and they're not being productive at that time. So, I don't get it. Some of the decisions they make, you know, may be legitimate. There may be other reasons why that they don't announce, or I just don't understand. But on the surface, they make a lot of contradictory decisions. So, I don't know. It's beyond me sometimes. So, approaching the 10 o'clock hour. I do have some other news we can go through, but we save that for the 11 o'clock hour or after we finish our discussion on Clear Lake, which could take quite a while, folks. There's a lot to talk about, both from a political point of view.
To me, it's pretty simple. I do not have a lot to say about
it. I do.
Well, good for you.
Because excuse my French, I'm pissed off. And not just at the bill, the ordinance, but the way the ordinance was handled, some of the attitude of the council people, and some of the attitude of staff, which I'm definitely going to talk about and call them out.
Boy, that's for sure.
So we'll do that. You want to take a quick break?
Yeah, let's do that.
And then we get into the click. Oh, pussycat.
He passed away.
Oh,
I know.
Whose was it?
My friend Pam's.
Oh. So almost sad. A Flash lookalike.
He had heartworm.
Oh. So.
What do you think about that, Flashy?
That's what you do for having an outdoor cat.
My
so.
Baby.
Anyway.
Yeah, that's the problem with outdoor cats. They really are susceptible.
Yeah.
Okay, so I need to figure out where we're at here. Oh. We're going over
what
to here.
What type of music we're having today?
We're going to have a nice something from Klondiken, and it's called Pay the Fiddler.
Okay.
It's all about responsibilities for the actions that you do.
Well, I think the way this county is going, you should put Eve the Destruction on.
I'll dig it out.
All right.
I'll get it out from the archives.
And I'm not trying to be pessimistic here, folks.
Pessimistic.
But, you know, what did I say?
Pest.
Well, that's because I had Flash next to me. Pessimistic. Pessimistic because I don't want to be negative, but, you know, our elected officials, and I hate calling them out all the time, but I'm just, I don't get it. That's all.
I know. It's frustrating.
It is.
Okay, so we're going to go to a break, and we'll be back in a flash.
Right here.
Hey, Flash.
That's my joke.
On Lake County Magazine.
All right, guys.
Starry night, I came upon a fire burning bright. Music filled the earth, felt so right that the people there should dance into the night. Everybody wants to dance, everybody wants to dance, everybody wants to dance, but who's going to take a little? Always got to face the light of day. Everybody wants to dance. Everybody wants to dance. Everybody wants to dance. But who's going to make the middle of the night? The fire cling to when it shoots its flames into the night, and when it shows its brilliance, ask yourself what feels that like. Everybody wants to dance, everybody wants to dance, everybody wants to dance, but who's going to get a pillow? Of Siberia, they got to dance in Afghanistan. Wanna dance in Kofi Land? They wanna dance in Poland. But who's going to pay the fiddle? Whoa, whoa, whoa. Pay the fiddle, 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 la 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 la. And the fire had burned all that fuel away. There was no one left to pay. So the fiddler just walked away.
who's going to pay the freaking fiddler? That's what I want to know.
You know, Flash, you could turn around so the folks don't have to look at your butt.
That's some Klondiking for you.
There you go. Turn him around. That's better. Much better.
Kitty face. There
much better view than the other
so,
one.
So, yeah, he's on his way to the vet. That's why he's here today. He's 18 and he needs a checkup.
Yes.
So, thank you for joining us again. This is Terry and Pete.
That's me.
And we're on Lake County Magazine on the delayed version.
Yeah.
Unfortunately. Hopefully, we'll be able to get live one day.
Again.
Yeah.
We will. One way or another, I'm going to get it fixed.
Boy, so frustrating.
Yes, it is. So, anyways, 10 o'clock hour on Wednesday, March 4th. March 4th.
Yes, it is.
So, unfortunately, we're going to get into a subject that's going to put me in a real rant. But that's okay. I'm going to be polite about it as much as I can. So, last Thursday evening, the wisdom of the Clear Lake City Council once again...
wisdom is not the word.
...brought its ugly head.
Ugh.
Don't you know sarcasm?
No.
No. You want to take this? And
no.
Then I'll add my two comments?
Go ahead and intro it, and I'll take it from there.
All right. First of all, as I said, the Clear Lake City Council met on Thursday to do the second reading of the new marijuana no-grow ordinance.
Zero tolerance.
Zero tolerance. First of all, this is an extremely important issue that has a major impact on the city, both from a, quote, according to real estate magnate, what's his first name?
David Hughes.
David Hughes has a tremendous impact on the curb appeal of the city for potential real estate buyers. Then you have the economic impact of seeing the money generated through this industry disappearing from the city of Clear Lake. So it's a very important issue, both morally, financially, whatever. We had one missing person in action.
Joyce
Overton. They said it was a family emergency, so I'm not doubting.
But it was planned in advance, so I don't know how emergency it could be.
Yeah, I'm not going to say if it's right or wrong, but, you know, this is a very important issue. I would expect all council people to be there. And then Mr. Russell Purdock was calling in.
From San Diego.
So I'm not sure why he was in San Diego, again, for an important issue. So they had four representatives out of five on the council, with one calling in long distance. There really was no voice of reason except for Bruno, help me again.
Sabatier.
Sabatier. I always accent the wrong syllable.
Yes,
there.
You do.
Sabatier. And I'm sure he's going to be listening eventually to this show. He was the only voice of reason. But
don't eat my
the
bicycle.
City voted 3-1 to pass the ordinance. So we now, once they have 30 days for it to become lawful or put into law, and then there's going to be a complete 100% ban on both indoor and outdoor grows. And my wife will give you kind of a quick overview of what transpired, and then I'm going to go into some of the personalities and some of the things which to the general public, and that's what we are, even though we're there representing, quote, media to a certain extent, it was a joke. It was absolutely a joke, and it was so evident and so obvious that except for Bruno, no one gave a damn about the patients that require the cannabis product, be it...
Who cannot afford to buy it from dispensaries.
Right. Well, the other part of this is they can't even get it from dispensaries at this point, because once the ordinance goes into effect, dispensaries can't grow either.
Exactly.
Which violates...
Not only that, the way it's written, you can't even have possession.
Possession's illegal.
Okay, so what they're doing is effectively outlawing all cannabis within the city limits, whether you have a right to smoke it medically or ingest it medically or not.
Right.
It will be illegal throughout the entire city.
Right. This is based on the definition of cultivation. And this was a somewhat debated issue between the city attorney and the council. And realize no one on the council, no one in staff except for the city attorney, who's basically representing a law firm that has a contract with the city, is a lawyer. or understands legal contract, for better choice of words. And so the definition of cultivation included, and I think we read this last week or the week before, includes any part thereof of the plant, and basically said cannot be stored. Well, any part of the plant is what you guys call, I think, the flower, right? And that flower provides you the product to smoke or to convert into edibles or whatever the case may be. And so it says the storage thereof. Therefore, storage can mean having it literally placed in your home, your vehicle, on your possession. And since storage is defined as such, basically possession of cannabis is illegal. And this was brought up to the city attorney, and the attorney basically said, well, it's the intent of the ordinance, not the actual language of the ordinance. And many people, including Russ Purdock, basically stipulated, well, we trust our staff to do the right thing, and they're not going to go out of their way to enforce such items, nor will the police try to enforce that, because it's not the intent of the law. I got news for you, folks. If anyone has ever had any encounters with law enforcement or with staff regarding code enforcement, you know damn well that each individual interprets the code or the laws in their own individual way, and they take direction from their superiors. So if someone gets a bug up their butt regarding a certain situation, they can enforce the language of the law any way they want. And to outright ban possession, I think, violates state law. And that was one
yeah,
of the
things. Yeah, it does.
It does. Hi, Flash. And along with Denise Lucillo and Gina
Fortuna Dixon
all kind of said, well, yeah, you know, our staff are really good people, and they're really tolerant, and they understand what the law is going to be and all that good stuff. And I'm like, well, I didn't see the code enforcement officers at the meeting. All I saw was an attorney. The chief of police was there. He didn't say boo about anything except when he was asked why he didn't enforce the current law, and his statement was, I'm not allowed to. It's an ordinance. It's not a criminal matter. Which to me is a bunch of bullshit. Because when you see 100 plant grows, it's very obvious that there's something wrong in Denmark, folks. This isn't a patient growing the 3, 4, 5, 6 plants. This is a money-based operation. It violates state law because they're making it for profit. It's not a collective. It's not product being provided back to patients. It is an outright grow. And you can call it the Mexican Mafia, you can call it whatever you want, but they're illegal. But yet the chief of police says, well, it's not a criminal offense, it's a civil ordinance impact. We're not allowed to enforce it. Really, guys? Come on, give me a break.
That just is what really upsets me, because they're using this ordinance as an excuse not to enforce.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the biggest problems I have.
Exactly.
Is that the cops are saying, oh, it's a zoning problem. So if you have 100 plants, even though you're breaking the law anyway by having that many plants, even according to state law, they still don't see it as breaking the law.
Right. So, you know, I would love
– the hypocrisy we're dealing with.
Right. And I guess because it's within the city of Clear Lake, the sheriff's officers aren't really – interfering in that. So that'd be a very good question for Sheriff Martin when we can get him back on the show to find out his viewpoint on that and why his staff can't go into the city of Clear Lake and get rid of these big grows. So the attitude was pretty horrendous by the council, because, again, even though we're trying to have minimal public comment against the ordinance, because we had over 300 people last time doing this, we still had several speakers go up there, including my wife. And we have video that, unfortunately, I screwed up the video last night, so I'm going to try to get it ready for next week. I converted it into the wrong format, and it won't play on our broadcasting equipment. But my wife had a very good 1 minute and 58 seconds speech on addressing the council. And then there was a 12-minute, and I'll call it a speech, that Bruno Sabatier, got it right this time, Bruno, did. He was very well prepared because he knew that he was going to be the lone person out there trying to come up with a reasonable compromise. And he had went on a tangent in a very polite way discussing the problems with the ordinance that was about to be passed, some of his recommendations or ideas to make it more of a compromise. And he brought in some very good points, including the legality of some of the language in the ordinance, which we discussed, the lack of enforcement, again, which is what the current problem is with the current ordinance, is that there's no teeth to it. There's no enforcement actions to it. It was enforced by code enforcement, and at the time, there were no code enforcement officers. So people could do what they damn well want. Don't blame the public because you can't enforce the ordinance.
Well, that's what they're doing. They're making the average citizen in the poorest town, in the poorest county, in the state of California, pay the price for their laziness and their incompetence.
Yeah, exactly.
It's criminal.
It is criminal.
And it's just ridiculous. So, responses. We can talk about responses now?
By
the people?
Yeah, go ahead.
Citizens are responding. There is a lawsuit pending at the moment that's getting ready to be filed, basically challenging the whole ordinance, but also the possession section particularly. In addition, there's a referendum that will be hopefully completed by the end of this week, and signatures start being taken to put this on the ballot, possibly for a special election. And then there's going to be a boycott of all the businesses, including Enterprise Towing and Automotive Repair, and David Hughes Realty, Realty World, and several other businesses. Main Street Grill, we've heard also. Any business that is supporting this ordinance is going to be boycott. I do have to say one of the other restaurants who originally did support the ordinance has kind of rethought the issue, and hopefully we'll be able to meet with them to see if they're willing to change their position. But all the people really want is an ability to grow for their personal use. These are not 100 plant grows people. These are 6 plants or less. These are people who need to do it themselves because they can't afford to shop in a dispensary. And the way this ordinance is written, dispensaries cannot grow or store any part of the plant within their premises. So effectively, they're out of business too. So there's going to be multiple lawsuits on this, and there is strategy in place, which we're not at liberty to talk about, but the strategies are going forward, and the city's going to pay through the nose for this. An already bankrupt city to begin with is now going to have to pay out tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars in legal fees to stand up for this ordinance that literally is affecting people's lives and could possibly end in people's deaths. This is the problem here, folks. If you can't get your medicine, then some of these people who have cancer and some of these more debilitating diseases will actually die. And those deaths will be on the conscience of the city council. Obviously, there's one person on the council that death doesn't seem to bother, and he doesn't seem to have much of a conscience. But you know what? The others are human beings, I believe, and they do have a conscience. So I just think that it's very sad that the city of Clear Lake could be so unfeeling and, you know, lack so much compassion that they're just willing to put the lives of their own citizens on the line, even after people have come to them and pled. And people like Adelia Klein, who basically has said that, you know, her little son, who has extremely violent seizures, will not be able to get his medicine. And because of that, he's going to go back to these horrible seizures that he had before she started giving him the CBD oil for his seizures. And by the way, the state of Missouri just made CBD oil legal, even though that cannabis is not legal at all in the state of Missouri, but they just did the law to legalize CBD oil for children with seizures.
The production of it or just the use of it?
Both.
Cool.
Yeah. So that was a major coup that just happened recently.
Right.
But unfortunately, Clear Lake's still in the dark ages, and they don't seem to understand that this is a – we grow the best quality cannabis in the world, right here in Lake County. And instead of seeing this as an industry that they could turn into making real medicine for real patients, like little boys that need seizure medicine, or little girls, or elderly people with cancer, they'd rather outlaw it and turn everyone into a criminal. Thanks a lot, folks. We really appreciate your cooperation.
Yeah, I was going to throw some sense of humor in there, folks, but it's not funny situation. And it's, you know that we're pro-cannabis, but that's not the issue here. The issue is patients, Vietnam veterans, people who have had other illnesses are suffering, and they do need their cannabis. Matter of fact, we went to our doctor yesterday, as we mentioned earlier, and he is very fascinated with the impact from the utilization of cannabis, especially the edibles, right, and the CBD oils. And here's a MD who
works in the clinic,
governed
right
by
downtown
the
Clear Lake.
American Medical Association. They got to be very careful what he does with the use and prescription of cannabis. And he is extremely interested in watching the results of that. Can I mention your toe?
Yeah, I was going to talk about
Go
it.
Go ahead.
So I went to see the same doctor a couple weeks ago. And I've had a problem on and off with that fungus that gets underneath the toenail. And the toe had almost turned black and scared me a lot. So I went to go see him and he said, oh, it's just that same fungus, nothing to worry about. You know, it's going to just keep, we'll get you on some kind of medicine or whatever. So somebody had given me a sample of some cannabis salve and I started applying that because I was having a lot of pain in that foot between my arthritis and this toe. So when I applied it, the pain went away, and I could go throughout the day without having any problems. And instead of not only taking the pain away, it actually started to take away the blackness and change the color of the toenail. And so I showed it to him yesterday, and he was amazed because he had just seen it like a week or so ago. And he said, please keep me posted on the progress of that because – actually, cannabis is an antifungal, and so what is happening is it's seeping in through the nail, and it's attacking this fungus under the nail. So now, instead of being black, it's more like a light brown, and it looks 100% better. And of course, I'm not having the pain or anything either. So, you know, every day we find out something new that this wonderful plant can do to help people's health, and it's just really a shame that we have such backward leadership here in the county, not just in Clear Lake, but in the county itself.
And Lakeport.
Yeah.
So, again, it has nothing to do – well, it does, but it's the point of the lack of understanding or the personal agendas of the members of the city council.
Exactly.
And I think it's the latter. I think that the mayor, Lucillo, has a vindictive attitude towards the growing of cannabis. Her neighbor actually stood up and made himself recognized as in public comment and said, I'm the one that caused this problem. I grew my six plants under the legal allowance under the current ordinance, and I'm the one who caused this problem because I was abiding by the law. Code enforcement came out, which was actually the building inspector, came out and realized that I was in full compliance, but yet the mayor and her husband and the other neighbors were extremely upset because they were large plants. And that's because this gentleman knows how to grow correctly. He gave a lot of his product away for medicinal purposes. He did provide some where he was reimbursed for his expenses for growing and his time, which is allowed under state law. But they were just pissed off.
They were mad he was getting compensation for the work that he put into this.
I mean,
you know, when they talk about a nonprofit in the industry and that you have to have a nonprofit to be have a dispensary and blah blah blah, what that means is it doesn't mean that you can't make any money. It means you could make a salary within reason, and that the excess profits go back into your business. The fact that people get jealous that farmers are being compensated for their time and the cost of their materials is ludicrous.
Well, don't the wine people get compensated?
Don't enterprise towing mechanics get compensated for the work they do?
Hell yeah.
All right. So why shouldn't a good farmer who knows what he's doing be compensated for a very high-yielding plant that he grows?
Well, I'm going to turn the tables a little bit here and say the pharmaceutical companies, they manufacture medicine. They provide it to doctors or pharmacies who then sell it to the general public.
And they make
every
big
single
profits.
Of the way, there's a profit margin involved.
Absolutely.
And this is, does not require to be a nonprofit under our current laws. They can make as much money as they want. So I don't know about you folks, but if I'm working hard, I need to be compensated. I'm not a multimillionaire. And if I'm going to put forth X number of hours into producing a product for the benefit of somebody else, I got to get compensated. So there's nothing wrong with that. What they're trying to establish through the state laws is to make sure people aren't make unreasonable compensation because it's a product that until recently was illegal, or to control the abuse of the product. So I can deal with that because it's still an what's the word I'm looking for? I apologize. It's not a regulated industry per se in the sense of it's not a crop.
That's part of the problem.
Exactly.
It's not being seen as an ag crop, so there's no regulation.
Right. So anyway, a couple other things I want to talk about this meeting. You know, I'm 63 years old now, and I consider myself somewhat intelligent. I'm somewhat educated. I've been around the world. I've experienced other cultures and other standards of living, both better and worse. And I get offended when there's no respect given either to myself or to the general public.
Mm-mm.
And this whole meeting was extremely disrespectful to those who are against the ordinance. So I'm going to give you a few examples. One, Mr. Hughes, which he had full right at public comment to express his opinions. I have no problem with that. Just because I disagree with everything he said doesn't mean I'm right or that he doesn't have the right to make those comments. This still is the United States of America, and allegedly we still have free speech. So he was making some comments about how the pot industry, i.e. the number of grows in Clear Lake, is a detriment to the housing market, i.e. the value of homes, and that people would come up out of the Bay Area or otherwise to look at homes in Clear Lake and get turned off who don't want to buy because they see some pot plants growing. Now, if he was referring...
Now, mind you, in San Francisco, pot plants grow on people's patios.
Exactly.
And you can see them from the street everywhere
right.
you go.
So, you know, I don't personally think if someone saw a couple of plants in someone's backyard and they were buying a house within a couple of houses, unless they're really anti-cannabis, which some people are, I don't believe that would turn somebody off from buying a home. If you were buying a home next to a Mexican mafia 100-plus plant grow, yeah, I can understand that. But then I'd be the first one to call the cops. If the local cops don't want to do something with it, I call the county. If the county didn't want to do something with it, I call the state. If the state didn't want to do it, I call the feds. Someone's going to take care of those 100-plus grows. That does impact the real estate market. The one or two at home for medicinal purposes is really not going to impact the real estate market, in my opinion. Mr. Hughes thought differently. And again, he's allowed to express that. So after he finished his public commentary, he sat down, just like my wife when she finished her commentary, sat down. But during the negotiation or the battering back and forth of what to do with this ordinance, Mr. Hughes, who was sitting three chairs to the right of me, kept on saying out loud, just vote on it. Don't make any changes. Just vote on it.
Oh, my God.
No, that's not right. Just vote on it and get it over
well,
with.
Well, I think I was mouthing off a little, too.
Yeah,
maybe
a little bit.
Maybe he felt he had to mouth
but
off.
I just but my wife went up to do something else. I think she was mingling among some of the other crowd members. And Hughes just really spoke up again. I turned around, and maybe not the most professional thing to do, maybe not even the most mature thing to do. I turned around and looked at him, just basically told him to shut his effing mouth. I said, you already had your right to speak during public commentary. Let the elected officials discuss this and come up with their own results, be good or bad. depending upon what side of the fence you're on. He started speaking up again. I just looked at him and said, shut up. Mind your own goddamn business at this point. And we had three police officers, one of them being Officer Selly.
Yeah, Lieutenant Selly.
I apologize. Lieutenant Selly. They were just giving me the biggest smiles you wouldn't believe. And they were just
you
like.
You know what I really hate? I actually like the cops in CPD, personally. I think they're, you know, they're probably doing the best they can do, but that's still not good enough, you know. And it just, it's a quandary because I want to like them, but I can't like them because they don't do a good job.
Well, you know, they take direction from their boss.
Right.
So, you know, the buck stops at the top, folks.
Right, right.
So we can go from there.
Yeah.
So the other thing that kind of bothered me is that Hughes kept on saying, you know, repeating myself again, it's the pot, it's the pot, it's the pot. Well, folks, let me tell you a quick story. When my wife came up here and bought our home, I wasn't here. I was still in Phoenix doing what I had to do. The first time I flew up here, she picked me up at Sacramento. We drove up, and I'm looking at the beautiful mountains and the hills between Sacramento and Lake County. Really say, no, something. This is a really cool place to live. It really looks nice. It's country, rural. You know, it's totally different than what we've been used to in Phoenix. Then she drove me on 53 coming off 5, right? Whatever it's called. And she drove me past Clear Lake.
We came in on the 20.
Okay, this is where the fast food joints are. I'm like, okay, there's Walmart. Okay. So we drove in the lower lake and we got home. And, you know, nice environment. I think the next morning or the next day, she says, I'm going to take you through Clear Lake. And I'm telling you guys, I came up to the stoplight where Lakeshore Boulevard hits 53. And we turn on to Lakeshore Drive. And she starts driving down. And I said to myself, oh, my God, what has she done to me?
And he didn't see one pot plant.
Yeah, and that's the point, folks. I saw some of the homeless. I saw the presentation of some of the homes and the businesses, the smoke shops, the cigarette shops. And I'm like, oh,
really?
Lord, what happened to my middle-class subdivision environment? My point here, folks, is the cannabis plants didn't turn me off. Matter of fact,
we didn't see any. I've never really smelled any pot in Clear Lake.
You know, I saw the vineyards coming in, and I said, ah, kind of cool. I love wine. But I didn't see any pot plants. What turned me off was the fact that there was no curbside appeal to Clear Lake. Every city has homeless. I don't care where you're at. Even Hollywood has homeless. Even though it's somewhat of a distraction to a home buyer, like what type of environment am I getting myself into, it was the curb appeal. The houses were dilapidated. There was no nice new fresh paint on them. There were no sidewalks. There was no lighting down the street. There was no, this is downtown Clear Lake. We got the lake next to us here. We got some little cafes here. There was nothing like that. It was just like, ugh, why do I want to live here? So to Mr. Hughes' response that the quality and the pricing of our real estate market and why people do not want to live in Clear Lake is because of pot, he's full of shit. He really is. He doesn't have a clue, or he doesn't want to admit it, or he's
no,
so
he doesn't
anti-cannabis.
Want to admit it. They want to blame everything on pot.
Right.
It's easier that way.
And, folks, I don't care if you've lived here for 30 years or you're relatively new to the area, I think you're going to agree with me or at least understand my perspective that when you're looking for property to buy in, especially if it's a home, your primary home, you're looking for a nice surrounding within your price range. And going to Clear Lake with the nasty roads, the dilapidated housing, the boarded up red flag, red tagged housing, it's not a conducive environment to buy a home. So, Mr. Hughes, I doubt you'll ever listen to this show, though I may send you a copy of it. Get off your high horse, get off your own personal agenda, and realize that if you really are sincere about improving the quality of Clear Lake and improving the real estate market in Clear Lake, you need to understand the economic impact and the curb appeal that's affecting your clients. And maybe you just don't know how to sell. Maybe you're not maybe the best realtor in town, because I know other people are selling houses in Clear Lake.
And property values have actually gone up,
yes.
Not down.
So
that's another lie. And he went to the judge's breakfast and told people that, And then he goes up in front of the city council and says, oh, the property values are dropping.
Right. So I'm going to do some research on the real estate market in Clear Lake and find out what the impact has been on pricing. Has it gone up? Has it gone down? How many houses have been sold versus prior to this? And get a really good feeling on the proper way of approaching the valuation of the problems within Clear Lake.
That would be good.
So that's one problem I really had with the meeting. Next one, which unfortunately I lost my composure and I admit it, because when people disrespect me, I am not a very nice person, and I admit that. You can tell me I don't like you. You can tell me I don't like your personality. You can tell me you think I'm stupid. That's fine. I can deal with that because that's your personal opinion, and you have enough guts to tell me to my face. I can deal with that. But to be disrespected is another matter, and I don't tolerate that very well. So a few weeks ago, after the first reading of this ordinance, we had Bruno in here, I believe, and I made a commentary about the finance manager or director of the city of Clear Lake basically providing inaccurate or false information to the council. And that included his report on the actual real cost of code enforcement for marijuana or cannabis. I tore that apart because as an accountant of 25 plus years and having worked for very large corporations,
including
American Airlines, I know how to put numbers together and I can make them say anything I want. And in regards to the budgetary requirements in American Airlines, I was accountable to the board of directors and they dissected everything I did. Not to digress, but what the finance manager did was, and this is from information provided to me by people in the city of Clear Lake, that he was using a factor of including all the costs associated with that enforcement. That includes the police officer's time, the benefits he's paid, the payroll taxes involved, the allocation of overhead and indirect costs involved in the enforcement. So it was, I won't say it's an inflated figure, but it's a figure that's not accurate when it comes to the actual true cost of enforcement.
It's totally deceptive because what they're basing it on is the hourly rate and the health benefit compensation that the officers get. And what that translates to is money that they're already spending. This was not a special overtime. Sorry. This was not based on anything other than their hourly rate, which they're already getting paid. So that cannot be a valid way to calculate an expense.
Right. If I was doing the scenario, what I would be doing is saying, okay, was an officer called in on his day off to do this enforcement? Was an officer who was on duty, was he going into overtime, which normally he would not have incurred,
then
to do the enforcement action? Was there any direct cost to remove or to enforce the code in regards to the abatement of the plants? Was there any cost to get into the property? Those are costs that normally would not be incurred on a day-to-day basis. Those are true costs associated with the code enforcement of marijuana ordinance. That's not what he did. He used all of these other indirect and overhead costs along with people who were already on duty. Did it take away from other duties? Of course they did. It took away from traffic control. It took away from maybe going after other types of criminal activity.
But still. I mean,
could have taken away from their coffee break.
If you ever look at the log notes for City of Clear Lake, 90% of it is log note taken. Period.
Right.
There's
so
no follow-up, no action.
So anyway, so I called him out. I didn't mention him by his personal name. I just said the finance manager, director. And, you know, it is what it is, folks. You know, I don't hide.
We understand this thing. Yeah. A lot of people don't understand how accountants come up with the figures that they come up with. We get it. And we can tell you how it's calculated.
Right. So
he didn't like that.
So anyway, so what happens is they did a 10-minute break in the council meeting. And I went over to talk to the attorney, which I'll get into in another second. And I saw the finance manager coming back to his chair. And he was standing up. And I said, excuse me, sir, could I ask you a question? And he looked right at me and said, no. And I'm like, excuse me? He said, all I want to do is ask you one simple question. No, I'm not going to answer your question, and turned his back towards me. Well, needless to say, I
Your
lost
question
it.
Was probably about how he came to that
exactly
figure, right?
Exactly, it was, yes. Okay. And I really almost lost it. And he started going towards his seat next to Joan Felipe, the town manager. And I said, excuse me, I don't understand. All I want to do is ask you a simple question. He said, I am not answering your question. End of discussion. And I looked at Joan, and Joan and I have disagreed on many, many subjects. And I'm the first one to tell you that. But she always talks to us. Doesn't matter we like her answers, but she will at least talk to us. And I looked
and
at her.
And she's always polite.
Yeah, she is. And I looked at her and said, is this how you coordinate your staff? Is this is how your staff is supposed to respond to the general public? He's an employee of the city. He is accountable to the general public.
And,
all I wanted,
and you're a member of the media. That's even worse.
All I want to do is ask him one question only, and he absolutely turned his back on me and said, I'm not talking to you, period, end of discussion. And I started getting a little bit boisterous, a little bit heated, because that was just outright disrespectful. He didn't give me a reason. He just turned his back on me. So at the end of the meeting, after the city...
Well, let's throw in the last thing that it ticked you off so badly and stressed you out so badly, that you actually had a seizure and went down on the ground in front of everybody as well.
Yeah, and Lieutenant Selle
came
over and literally was about to call the paramedics. He was extremely sincere and caring, wanted to make sure I was all right. Obviously, my wife said it's cool. We're used to it. It's not a big deal. But I give him credit, and I want to thank him again.
Awesome.
He was awesome. He really was sincere in making sure I was okay.
That's why I say individually, the officers I know are good-hearted people. But they've got terrible leadership, and they're not doing what they need to do for our community.
Right. And actually, I told Lieutenant Say, I said, you know, that really wasn't necessary. I said, yeah, it was. It's part of my job.
Yeah.
I have to make sure that everyone.
He did good.
Yeah. So, you know, he has no attitudes. At least
now he's always nice to us.
Yeah. So,
and he knows we criticize him all the time.
Yeah, but you know,
but that's our job. We got to call a spade a spade.
Right.
You know, if you're not doing it right, then we want to know why. Is it right that the CPD gets off the hook in enforcing issues that are valuable to the community, and that the leadership turns around and makes the citizens pay for their not doing their job?
Right.
No, that's not right.
Well, there's a difference here, folks, is that, and I'll use Anthony Farrington as an example. We've been very critical of some of the decisions he's made. Yet the other day when we saw him at the wine and chocolate thing, not only was he pleasant and friendly with us.
Although he wasn't sure about giving me a hug.
No, well, you know, his wife was right
next
to him.
No, it had nothing to do with her. It's just, he's like, I don't think I should be seen hugging you in public.
Yeah, but the point is, he was attentive to us. He was professional to us. Doesn't matter what his opinion of us were or what we disagreed on. He had the courtesy of saying, hey, guys, how are you doing? Oh, here's my wife over here. Maybe we guys need to talk to each other.
Right.
He was complimentary and polite.
Very polite. And I find that Lieutenant Selle has always been
so
that way, and Sergeant Bennett and the other people that we've had interactions with as far as media is concerned.
So my point here, folks, is that you have to separate your professional life from your personal life. I don't care if you're a law enforcement officer. I don't care if you're staff on a government or you're an elected official.
Exactly.
If you're in those positions, you know you're going to get criticized. You can't win. Jesus Christ. Why did
you're too tall.
I like being tall.
No, I don't like looking up at you.
I'm the man here. She's messing with me, folks.
Sorry, folks. I couldn't resist.
Anyway, you understand my point here. So anyway, get back to the story. After the meeting was over and the city council voted 3-1 to pass the new ordinance, the finance manager, director, came right up to me and said, do you want to know why I wouldn't ask you a question? I'm like, I would.
Actually?
Well, I heard your radio show, and I didn't like what you said. And I'm like,
gee,
really?
Tough crap.
Said, yeah, I don't like what you said. You had no fact base. And he really was getting in my face.
No facts?
And I
really
basically told him, sir, get the F out of my face, or you're going to be paying for it. He said, all you had to do was come up to me and say, Mr. Schiffman or Mr. Lake County Magazine or whoever you are, here's the reason why I didn't want to ask you a question. And if you want to sit down and discuss it, we can. But I didn't appreciate your comments on your radio show, and I don't believe your facts were correct. And my answer is, well, you could have contacted me after the show was over or after you heard the show, and we could sit down at
it's
your
so
office
simple.
Over a cup of coffee. Yeah. We could have discussed
why,
it.
Why, if he disagreed, why didn't he just contact us?
Yeah, or even when I asked him, can I ask you a question, all we had to do was say, excuse me, I heard your show. I didn't feel that you had all the correct information, and I felt that you were wrong in your commentary. So after the meeting's over, we can sit down and chat about it, or why don't you call my office, and we'll set up a time to get together. But his reaction was just not
rude.
The way that a staff member should have reacted.
Absolutely.
And I've lost all respect for him in regards to his maturity level and working with the public.
Well, I'm sure he felt really bad when he saw you go down on the ground with your seizure,
I don't give a think
that's
he did.
Probably why he came over, because he's like, oh, man, I really did something to this guy.
And, again, Joan Felipe said, look, give me a call. Let's get together. We can go through the numbers, and we can go from there.
Okay.
And I'll be the first one to tell you, folks, if I'm wrong, I admit it. I will admit that he was right and I'm wrong, but I don't think that's the case. And he would not respond to my commentary. And, again, if you're a public official or putting yourself in a position as part of the council in providing information, you're going to be accountable for it. I mean, I didn't even get the chance to address his Google Earth shots,
which
were
2 years old.
Were not accurate.
He showed these pictures of supposedly grows in Clear Lake, and Mr. Sabatier went back and check the dates on the photos, and they were from 2013. That's before the current ordinance was even in effect. So what the hell is wrong with these people that they have to present a deceptive front in order to get what they want by lying to the people of Clear Lake and telling them a bunch of baloney that is not true?
Right.
Okay, this is what has me upset, because they built their whole case on lies, basically.
You have a kitty cat.
I do. He's so sweet. Yeah.
So the point is, folks, is that I don't appreciate the way staff reacts to our commentary or, in the case, criticism. They got to have bigger shoulders than that.
Absolutely. When you get into politics or work in government, you got to be ready to face the critics.
And we've talked about this when the initial ordinance was proposed, that we had the chief of police, we had the finance manager, and someone representing the fire department basically gave a one-sided overview of the problems with cannabis. And it was some of it was factual to a certain
extent. And they never
extent.
Invited anyone to show the other side. No. It was strictly a one-sided argument.
And I called it a dog and pony show.
Absolutely.
And that's exactly what it was. And
Absolutely.
It's obvious that way the finance manager reacted, that it was all set up.
Because he knows that you called him out on the truth, that he did not tell the truth.
Right.
And he's upset that you exposed him.
Absolutely.
Yep.
And
I said,
don't open your mouth if you're not willing to take the consequences.
And don't make presentations to the public if you don't want anybody checking your facts.
I mean, without going off half-cocked here, folks, is that my wife and I, through Lake County Magazine over the last few years, along with our radio show formerly on KPFC and now here, we have been targeted. Rob Brown has called us carpetbaggers from Arizona. We've had other commentary
anonymously.
Thank you. On the blog and in other commentary, stating that we're a bunch of losers, that we're a bunch of drug traffickers.
We found out from the neighbors the other day, a neighbor that we don't even know told a mutual friend, Oh, we know them. They're major drug dealers. Really?
Really, guys?
We don't buy and sell drugs at all, ever. So it's that kind of tactic that these people are using to try to discredit us and make you, our viewers and listeners, not believe the stuff that we're telling you. And you know what? This stuff really is hard to believe.
It is.
It's almost like living in the Twilight Zone when you see the kind of travesties that go on here on a daily basis.
Matter of fact, some of the people who are trying to help override the new ordinance, I was told by several of them that they're now getting personally attacked.
Oh, really?
They're being targeted.
Huh.
So this is the tactics that officials use when we call them out, and I believe they know we're right and they're wrong, even though that's not going to stop them. So they start targeting individuals who are against them. And it's weird. Matter of fact, funny story is after the meeting was over, after we finished our little chit-chat with some of the people, we started driving home. We go down 53 onto 29, and I was I was making a right-hand turn onto 29, just past the Tower Mart.
In our 2002 Mercedes SLK 320.
Right, and all of a sudden I see these flashing lights behind me. I'm like, oh, crap. That's the last thing I need tonight is have the law enforcement officers of our area pull me over.
So we're like, okay, they called ahead from Clear Lake and told them to harass us, you know. So he comes over to the passenger side, and of course, coming out of the meeting, I'm all stressed out, so I had taken something out of the ashtray and just medicated. Peter does not medicate, and he certainly wouldn't do it if he was driving either. So I was having problems finding the registration because we haven't been pulled over in forever, and I had no idea where it was. So I'm looking through the paperwork, and the officer says, oh, how much weed do you have on you?
Yeah, first question.
Yeah, and I was like, well, I have personal use, just enough for my personal use, and I had just medicated. My husband doesn't smoke, and he's like, okay, well, I could just see him saying, step out of the car, please, and getting ready to search us when I hear, Terry, is that you? And I looked around to see our good friend Glenn, who is also a CHP officer, and he's like, what's up? And I said, oh, we just came from the Clear Lake City Council meeting. And he said, what happened? So we had to tell him the whole story of the meeting. And halfway through, Glenn looks over at his partner and he says, are we holding you up? And he's like, no, I want to know what happened too. So we end up giving the report to the guys. We got a warning on our ticket. I mean, on our taillight.
Our taillight was out.
It was
out.
Our taillight. You know, the roads here are so rough that what happens in my little car is there's this one box where all the electrical goes in, and it vibrates so much that things become loose, and I'll lose the electric seat, I'll lose the electric window, I'll lose even sometimes we lose the starter, and it'll die like right in the middle of driving it. So it seems that the problem with the bulb is something similar.
Right.
So, you know, thanks to the great roads of Lake County for vibrating my car to death, basically.
Anyway.
So anyway, it was a happy ending. You know, it was great to see him, and we were just, I hadn't seen him in a really long time. So we just had a little chat and went on our merry way.
It was kind of nice.
Thanks to CHP for being cool.
Right. The initial officer said, driver's license. I'm like, okay, hang on. Let me get my wallet out. And I pulled it out, and he started looking at it and was about to do his normal procedures. And that's when Glenn came back and started talking to my wife, and they didn't do anything. Gave me my license back, said, get the thing fixed and have a nice evening.
But, exactly.
You know, it's nice because,
One of the benefits of living in a small town, because once people know who you are, they're not going to harass you.
Right.
And I give thanks to CHP for being very reasonable.
Right. And
with
even
us.
The original officer, he was
pleasant.
Fine.
Yeah.
He was just doing his job. But
yeah.
What surprised me, folks, well, shouldn't have, is that the very first question out of his mouth was, how much pot do you have? I'm like, really? I thought that was legal here.
Unfortunately, there's a lot of people that traffic it.
Yeah, but
Lake
we
County,
got a Mercedes two-seater. How much pot can we put in that car?
Hey, that's
come
a pretty
on.
Good-sized trunk.
I mean, if I had the black Jeep that was always filthy and I had my hair down and my three-day growth
and
beard
been stopping
and
that
be profiled
before,
again, you know, I can understand that. But really, a Mercedes? Come on.
Oh, yeah, it represents so much money when it's how many years old now?
It's 13, 14 years old.
It's an antique
car. We drive
already.
Really expensive cars, folks. My Harley's a 99, our Jeep's a 95, Mercedes a 2002.
The boat's a 78.
we really have a lot of money tied up in our vehicles.
I know a lot of people are curious where we get our money from, but when you buy
we don't have any.
You can buy a car for, you know, 10 grand and a RV for 3,500 and a boat for 3,000.
Yeah, it is. You know,
it's not hard. You know, we work hard. Yeah. My husband works hard.
You know, folks, it's interesting. This may be boring.
Yes, we're kind of ranting
today.
That's
all right. You know, it's one of those days.
Yeah.
We keep on saying, maybe we need to buy a more fuel efficient vehicle. You know, it's new. But, you know, when you look at your payment, time you add the additional cost of insurance for a newer vehicle, compared to the gas mileage savings, it doesn't work out. It really doesn't. Even if you buy a $25,000 car, which is, I guess, maybe the average vehicle cost these days, you know, you're still looking at $300 a month plus payment. Your car insurance goes up another probably $600 a year because it's a higher value vehicle. It just doesn't make sense. It really doesn't. So we stay with our old cars until they fall apart and they no longer operate, not buying a new one. Though I had an idea. If we could put our boat at the dock, if we move the RV, that would save us $160 a month. We could actually buy an inexpensive fuel efficient.
We can't put our boat at the dock. So get that out of the head.
Well, we'd be able to buy a fuel efficient.
We'll get smashed up against the dock when the big winds come in.
Well, why don't if we get a actually
we're on the south end of the lake.
We could always put a 351.
Obviously, I'm the sailor in the family, folks.
We could put a 350 Cleveland engine down in the lake and tie it to a chain.
No.
Okay.
That's not going to work. Sorry.
Anyway.
Nice
so.
Try.
I'm cheap, guys.
Yes,
so.
You are.
Anyway, anyway, how did I get on that subject?
I don't know. I'm sure everybody's sick and tired of hearing about our ranting today.
Well, you know, I'm sure they are. But the point is, Clear Lake really screwed up.
Yeah,
and, you
did.
Know, between the referendum, between the litigation, and I don't know if you mentioned this or not, but town manager went to Terry after we're meeting and just with fear in her eyes said, when can I expect the litigation to start and when am I going to get the referendum?
Basically, she said, when are they going to serve us?
Yeah.
And I said, as soon as possible. Just
yeah.
be waiting.
You know,
it's coming.
And
it's just sad, you know. They just will cut their nose off despite their face
right.
and deny their own citizens the right to medicine
and clearly
based on personal issues.
Right. And Clear Lake is self-insured. They have a law firm they have on retainer to come to the meetings and make legal decisions that impact the county, the city. But, you know, they have, last time I saw, and again, I don't trust their bookkeeping, they had $150,000 in reserves, which is far, 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 far below the norm for cities in the state of California for reserves, for emergency things. They've already spent a lot of money on special elections. They've spent money on their little video they did. And that's taken a lot of money.
Which isn't even
right.
functional.
They took a lot of money out of their reserves. So if they got into litigation over this ordinance and they refused to back down or come up with a compromise, this city cannot afford litigation. And if they do pay for it, it's going to come out of the reserves because it's not part of their budget.
I don't think they can afford the boycott either.
And
because it's going to be people from outside the city that
right. So they're going to have less sales tax revenue.
That's
so
right.
They're putting themselves in a very
cutting
difficult economic situation. And it's very feasible this city could go broke. And it is going to go broke eventually once they have to start paying out their retirement funds. So they're putting themselves in a very precarious situation, and there's only one body to blame, and that's the council. I'm going to have one last point, then we can take a break.
Okay,
because I need a break.
Yes.
Is that time. Russell Purdoch, via the telephone, was adamant about the no-grows and how it was impeding the progress of the city. And this is coming from a gentleman. I want to be very careful how I say this because he was proven innocent.
He was never charged.
He was never charged, excuse
yes.
me. And we're going to get into this in another show about some of the information we have on hand right now that basically shows that he was, what's the word I'm looking for?
Under
here?
The influence.
Under the influence during that particular accident. And we have eyewitnesses who saw him drinking. We have a blood report, toxicology report, that shows he had other types of...
He had an over amount of oxycodone
okay,
in
I wasn't
going to
say that, but you just did.
At the time he was tested,
so,
which was the next day after the accident.
So I'm not bringing up the past.
So maybe he took some pills that day, I don't know, but it doesn't look very good.
Well,
and this evidence was not allowed to be presented to the court.
Right, so my point here is that not bringing up the past, but he had the balls to say in a public meeting that marijuana, cannabis, weed, pot is the worst thing that ever happened to the city of Clear Lake. And here's a man that was involved in an accident where there was a death of a young lady, right? That he
and
had.
A boat that he was driving.
Right, where he was impaired.
Possibly.
Allegedly impaired. And yet he's criticizing pot. There is a problem with that.
The hypocrisy there is overwhelming.
Right. And we're going to invite Mr. Purdoch on our show. I don't know if he's going to accept or not. So we can discuss this one-on-one without any he said, she said, innuendos and find out where he's really coming from. But to me, that is disgusting. making that type of commentary. Yep. So anyway.
It's very sad.
What do we got playing for us?
Jimi Hendrix, baby.
Cool.
And guess what the name of the song is? Tax Free.
Tax Free, yeah.
Okay, we'll be back here on Lake County Magazine with Terry.
And Pete, the
and
tax guy.
We'll see you in a minute.
All right. And we're back, folks. Sorry, we're playing with our kitty cat here, so we had a couple
getting
seconds
distracted. Oh, you can see him in the shot. Look.
Can you?
Yeah.
There you go. Sorry, folks.
Say
we
hi,
are.
Hi, Flashy.
Hey, Flash.
Yeah. So. Okay, so Flash is our guest today.
We were expecting another.
We thought that we'd have a guest, but I guess he's not going to be here till next week. I don't know.
That's
I'm totally confused.
So.
But so welcome, Flash. How's it going, bud? Oh, it's time for a bath? Okay.
All right, folks.
I'm sorry.
That's all right.
All right, so go back to your
final
comment.
Yeah, I have one last comment or rant and rave about the meeting is that towards the end of the discussions, after public comment was completed, Bruno went on a 12-minute speech, and I apologize. I had the video for that, but in converting it, I used the wrong format.
But people can go online and watch the whole meeting. Where is it at?
It's at on lightcomagazine.com. It is under news. Just click on LCM TV, and you'll find it there. And it's a very interesting speech that Bruno made, and it really just brought out the problems with the new ordinance, the changes he could have made that'd be more reasonable, that would have stopped the litigation and the referendum impact on the city. And I think he's obviously for a quality ordinance that's fair to both parties. But his speech, though, was really on what the end result will be for the city of Clear Lake and the people of Clear Lake from an economic impact because of the litigation and everything else. He was really concerned about the lawsuits because of some of the language in the ordinance. So, anyway, during the end of the meeting, he was really trying to convince somebody to vote on his side. And Gina
Fortino Dixon.
I'm sorry, Gina. Yeah, I am. I don't mean to mispronounce names. Started saying, well, maybe we can compromise here. And Bruno was like, oh, really? Okay. He said, I tell you what, if you're willing to vote for the zero grow ordinance, we can sit back and discuss how we can then improve that ordinance. And Bruno's like, wait a minute, let me make sure I understand. You want me to vote now so everyone votes yes for this ordinance on the promise that we'll sit down together and we'll figure out a new ordinance? Boy, that sounds like Lake County where after they passed the ordinance, said, well, we know
we'll
it's not perfect.
We'll do a dispensary ordinance.
Yeah. They're, you know, full of shit. Sorry, folks. And I really was put off by the fact that Gina was really trying to convince Bruno.
It seemed very tricky.
Yeah, it did. And I realize Gina might have been sincere in trying to compromise, but it just came across the wrong way. And luckily, Bruno was asking enough questions to understand her interpretation of what she really was meaning. And it finally came out that, yeah, just vote with us, and then we'll figure out what we can do in the future. We all know that doesn't work in our elected officials' capacity in this county.
You can't trust a politician.
No, you can't. So. Anyway, so that we'll finish ranting and raving about
so
that.
So it's pretty sad, folks. Yeah. I just don't know how it has gotten to this point. Yeah. Obviously, a lot of neglect by the law enforcement in not enforcing the big illegal grows that they know are illegal. A lot of blame game going on, blaming people for things that, you know, the patients are not the ones that are causing the problems. So it's just really sad.
And again, if you're interested in watching the meeting, even if you just want to go scroll through it to find out some important parts, it is up on our magazine. It really is something worthwhile, especially if you do live in the city of Clear Lake and or if you shop in the city of Clear Lake, i.e. Walmart, McDonald's, Carl's Jr. We all spend a lot of money over there, and I honestly think that besides the legal aspects of what we're trying to accomplish, the citizens, the residents of this county can have more of an impact by literally boycotting those businesses who are for the ordinance in the city of Clear Lake. And that's going to have a revenue impact on the small businesses, and it's going to have a major impact on the city as a whole by having less tax revenues collected. And I don't want to put anyone out of business, and that's not the intent. But these people have to understand that citizens can speak up and they can voice their opinion in other ways besides litigation and the other legal aspects. So I'm all for the boycotts. And, you know, it obviously is working because that one business called us or
Well, they made a statement saying they may be rethinking their
because they don't want to lose business
position. And we will publish a list of the pro ordinance businesses on Lake County Magazine for all to see.
Yep.
And we encourage you to support the boycott until these people come around and really start thinking about humanity and compassion instead of their personal issues and their personal peeves. I'm sorry. Right. It's bullshit.
Okay.
I think we said shit about four times now.
I know. I apologize, folks. And
sorry.
When we get on to some other different forms of media outlets,
we won't be able to do that. Now we can get away with it.
And I normally don't swear, but these guys have really just upset me to no end. So anyway, another thing that kind of upset us, and or you can look at this in a humorous way, is that also during the Board of Supervisors meeting yesterday, there was a discussion over, actually I think it was the animal shelter, had requested volunteers from the Sheriff's Department from the inmate population, and which, you know, I won't get into it. So the animal shelter said, hey, we really need help here. We don't have enough staffing. We can't afford the staffing. So they made an overture to the Sheriff's Department to see if they can get some inmates to come in and work either free or at their normal 10 or 25 cents an hour pay they get. And the sheriff responded in a very professional, polite manner. And unfortunately, I understood the sheriff's concerns that there was no security there. There was no video cameras. It was open to the inmates were exposed to prescription medicines, needles, syringes. And unfortunately, folks, no matter what type of crime you may or may not have committed to end up in the jail system, those are things that law enforcement has to be very, very careful of because they can be abused. So long make it short is that they were denied inmate labor at the animal shelter because there just wasn't enough security. There wasn't enough precautions to ensure the inmates weren't subject to being enhanced to use or abuse their privileges there. So anyway, Jeff Smith. Do we know Jeff Smith?
No, actually, I don't know him anymore. He's turned into some other creature that I can't recognize.
Yes, the alleged resident of Clear Lake, who represents Clear Lake.
Who really lives in Oregon.
Who represents our county as a supervisor. Yes, I'm being facetious.
Yes, so is he.
Oh, boy, that's getting low. Anyway, he made a comment, and correct me if I'm not stating this right, is that due to ABA, whatever it is, the state stating that we're releasing prisoners because of federal requirements, we're going to shove them back into the county level. Jeff Smith made a comment.
Like 104.
104, thank you. That, my God, do you understand what the impact is on this law making us take back these prisoners? They are so bad that they're not eligible to go out and work for free. So it's cutting down on the productivity or the use of inmate labor in government departments and or in contractors paying the county way above the 10 or 25 cents an hour inmates are paid. So they're actually making a profit off inmate labor. And Jeff Smith on record stated that the state is costing the county money and lack of labor force because of this.
AB 109.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
So in Arizona, this is very common. Matter of fact, the state is very upset when they can't negotiate contracts with third-party private companies to utilize prison labor. There's labor used for wildlife fire, whatever it's called in the state. They use inmate labor to go clean the highways and the streets or to clean up parks, both public and private, et cetera, et cetera. So for Smith to make a comment that there's not enough minimum security inmates available to provide the almost free labor out there and to be able to make money off those inmates who are when they have contracts with private companies, to me, it's disgraceful. It really is. Where's the rehabilitation part of this thing? Why are they always concerned about making money or utilizing inmate population to minimize their cost in government?
They don't care. When are you going to realize?
Oh, no, I realize it.
The leaders of this county and these cities do not care about the citizens in general. They care about the small elite group that they're involved in. That's all.
You know, I realize there's some bad people out there, folks, and I'm not trying to mitigate that that aspect of this, but there are a lot of people who are in jail and or prison who have committed some very minor offenses which caused no harm to the public. There was no damage to property. There might be minimal theft, like shoplifting, which I don't know about you, but most teenagers are prone to that type of crime. It's just ludicrous. I don't know. Maybe I'm hardened because of what happened to me, but I don't get it. It's just ludicrous. Instead of trying to put rehabilitation program, you know, and John Brosnan, during his campaign for District 5 supervisor, his emphasis was on why aren't we implementing some
district
type of
District 3, I think.
District 3. Why aren't we implementing some form of rehabilitation programs, drug abuse programs, alcoholic abuse programs, instead of concentrating on building more jail cells, putting more people away? Why aren't we focusing on that would help the county? Why aren't we looking at new job training for inmates? And, you know, he was right. Now, obviously, there's a cost impact on that. How are we going to come up with the money? What department going to take it from? But the point is, he's right. Instead of abusing inmates and making them work for free, they should be going into some type of program. And I especially believe job training programs. So,
absolutely.
That's my last rant, Ray, for the day.
Are you
folks.
Sure? This has been a really ranting day, folks. I really appreciate all your patience and understanding with our technical difficulties. And I hope you do stick with us because we're going places. We've got some things in the works that are going to be pretty phenomenal for Lake County. And we're very excited about where we're going at this point in our development. So we'll keep you posted on those things as they develop. But we're entering into some new partnerships and some new agreements with some local media here and also media outside of this area. So we're going to be providing a lot more information in a much more timely manner as soon as our streaming site gets back up.
The problem, folks, is we're streaming, but the end recipient, i.e. the streaming channel server, is not receiving our stream, which means that we're being provided the wrong IP address. So we're streaming, and it's going into cyberspace, and no one's receiving the signal. So we're working on that, and if that doesn't get rectified, we do have some other sources we can go to. I don't prefer not to, but we will if necessary, because obviously doing our live shows is very important to us and also provides a service to the community here. So
it's going to be interesting. We are on an interesting journey, and I'm thanking you for being with us and joining us in that. Okay, so I do have a kind of a humorous story.
Good.
This comes from High Times magazine. And the headline is, DEA warns that medical marijuana could lead to stoned rabbits.
What?
Yes. It's a headline, okay? Utah took a huge step forward in the realm of cannabis reform last week by giving initial approval to legalize medical marijuana. The proposal passed its first test after a Senate committee voted 3-2 to approve the bill. The initiative is expected to face an uphill battle in the conservative state and has already garnered the disapproval of the Drug Enforcement Agency. Of course, we're taking money out of their pockets. According to the Washington Post, a DEA agent presented testimony to a Utah Senate panel last Tuesday, detailing concerns about the state's wildlife if medical marijuana becomes legal. A member of the marijuana eradication team in Utah, Special Agent Matt Fairbanks, spoke about his work eliminating illegal backcountry cannabis grow sites and mentioned that he had seen rabbits that had cultivated a taste for marijuana. So is this bunny reefer madness? One of them refused to leave us, and we took all the marijuana around him, but his natural instincts to run were somehow gone, Fairbanks continued. Using stoned rabbits as a warning against marijuana legalization seems like a bit of a stretch. While it's probably the best, not the best idea to intoxicate your pets, lots of animals get high. And no harm ever comes of it. Last year, a flock of sheep in England ate 4,000 pounds worth of pot. In the Canadian Rockies, wild bighorn sheep go to extreme lengths to find rare narcotic lichens. Even some zoos give lions Christmas trees to play with due to the catnip-like effect they have on the cats. Seems like animals are always
well,
getting high.
Well, what's catnip made of?
Catnip's an, its own plant.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. So in honor of all the soon-to-be stoned rabbits in Utah, they've put together a list of some of the highest or highest-looking animals on the internet. So you have to go to hightimes.com to see the pictures, but... Oh, my goodness. How funny is that? So now we have to worry about getting rabbits stoned. Like, it really matters if a rabbit is stoned.
Well, you know, the way they cross the roads, maybe they'll be more careful.
Now, what they don't realize is that up till the 1930s, cannabis grew wild all over the country. Therefore, there is no way that, you know, these animals have already, that's why they're probably loving it now, because, again, like us, they have cannabinoid receptors in their brains as well.
That's right.
I know my kitty here, he just loves water leaves. He will go out of his way to eat the big leaves that come off the plants. He doesn't like the flowers.
He gets the munchies,
but he loves the leaves. And he's 18 years old, and he's still wandering around like a kitten. He plays, he jumps, he hops, he goes up and down the stairs. And, you know, he's doing a lot better than his brother who passed away, who didn't eat the leaves.
He gets up and down the stairs better than I do.
He really does, right, Flash?
Oh, any more human stories here?
I might have another one here.
Okay, in the meantime, this is kind of interesting, folks. This is one of the reasons why real estate prices are going up on the housing market is that Blackstone Group, we all know who they are, Colony Capital, and Cerberus Capital Management, these are all private equity firms. Obviously, Blackstone is a subsidiary of some of their other more famous companies. They have been buying all of the foreclosure homes from the banks at obviously discounted values and are now renting them out. So they're taking the surplus inventory of foreclosures off the market, generating rental income. And what that does, it brings up the real estate prices on surrounding homes in that neighborhood or that geographical area. So they are not only just getting rental income, they're now getting a realized capital gain growth on their investment. So they're basically getting income and growth in their investments simultaneously. So, you know, in this case, I can't fault them. They're taking inventory off the market. They're utilizing those properties, making sure they're in good repair because they have a stake in them, and that in turn generates a improvement in pricing around the neighborhood. Good news is those who are current homeowners are getting back the equity or at least getting back up to their mortgage value again. The bad news is people who want to buy homes, be it the first time buyer or those who are trying to take advantage of the market, they're going to hurt because prices are going up. But I found it interesting. I didn't realize that investment equity companies were actually buying a lot of the foreclosures, and that's why there's a lack of inventory on the market right now. So,
okay, I have something.
Yeah, go ahead.
So the Emerald Growers Association has a website called uniteforsungrown.org, and they basically have a whole page devoted to outdoor cultivation bans, saying they're bad policy. Bans are not compassionate. Many patients depend on the abundant sunshine in Northern California to produce their medicine. In California, all patients have the right to grow their own medicinal cannabis. If the patient lives on an appropriate parcel for this, cannabis should be allowed to grow in the sun. We oppose outdoor cultivation bans because it unnecessarily pushes the cost of cultivation up for patients, many who live on fixed incomes. Bans close the door on jobs. Keeping a conditional use permit option on the table for collective cultivation leaves the door open for continued economic development dialogue. I don't understand why this county is so against economic development on this medicine. Cannabis farmers around the state are hardworking business owners who create above-average paying jobs. A special permitting process for collective farms would allow communities to continue to engage in dialogue with job creators. Keeping the door open for dialogue about economic development is a common sense policy. Why ban the biggest opportunity for rural economic development of the 21st century? Bans are not enforceable. We need sensible regulation that allows counties to generate revenue. This revenue can be used to increase law enforcement and ensure that cultivation takes place in a manner that is consistent with community values. At the end of the day, it has been decades since our communities have not had illicitly grown outdoor cannabis. Simply passing a ban is not going to make it go away. This is what Clear Lake needs to understand. By making zero, people are just going to go ahead and grow what they want like they always have. We're going back to illegal growing again. An unenforceable ban will not improve our quality of life or improve public safety. Carefully regulated small businesses that create good jobs in rural counties will improve our quality of life. Communities that have safe access to their medicine will improve our quality of life. Now, many of you know that I work in the cannabis industry helping cancer patients and other people with chronic illnesses and chronic pain get the cannabis oil, the full extract cannabis oil that we use to heal these issues. With the ban in Clear Lake, this is going to significantly impact the people that get that oil, because we're not going to be able to get the product that is donated to us to be able to make the oil at low cost, to no cost. So there's a company down in LA that wants to invest in helping us build an industry here with this oil and have a place where it can be actually manufactured according to pharmaceutical standards. And that's not going to happen now because of not only the Clear Lake ban, but the ban on Measure N in Lake County. So it's just very shameful, because what they're doing is denying people jobs, good jobs, jobs that can pay well, not just Walmart jobs. Okay, the backwards thinking in this county has to stop. Bans violate private property rights. Property owners have the right to do what they want on their land, so long as it's not hurting others. With proper setbacks and on the right size parcels, landowners have the right to grow what they want without wasteful government overreach into their business and privacy. Bans are bad for air quality. Outdoor bans force patients to grow indoors. This uses a lot of electricity and is bad for air quality and the environment. Growing cannabis in the sun is all natural and doesn't make it hard to breathe. In addition, CBD plants and do not grow well indoors. They do not increase the amount of CBDs within the plant using artificial light. That plant needs sun grown in order to create the high CBDs. If Lake County was smart, they would develop an industry based on high CBD strains of cannabis. That would enable us to have an industry that could help children with seizures, that could help elderly with their pain issues without getting them high. Why aren't we thinking in this direction? Are we this backwards that we can only support the cartels and the illegal grows that seem to flourish in this county instead of building an industry that can actually heal and help people? And on that, that's my rant for the day.
Another one.
Yes. Well, I didn't really do much today.
No, it was mainly me.
D.C. police returned seized pot to residents. Cool. Police officers got a special order distributed to D.C. police specifying that residents that are illegally allowed to possess and use medical cannabis, that they can request any seized marijuana be returned to them. So that's nice.
That is.
Yeah. See, some states are actually cooperating with patients. God forbid Lake County does. They'd rather become the state of Jefferson. And, you know, there's some secrets about Jefferson that are actually kind of not good either. And this is not a person that I would like to have as the head of my state if I were having a state. He was a pretty bad guy overall. So that's a whole nother story.
You know, our founding fathers were not exactly perfect.
No, they weren't. No one's and they perfect. All grew hemp. And they all smoked it. Right, yeah. Flash?
He says, what, me? What? What's going on?
Right,
what?
Flash.
So.
Right, Flash, say hi to everybody.
Yeah. Another news release, since we're just kind of killing some time right now, is that the Justice Department just stated they were not going to prosecute the Ferguson police officer that killed the young man.
Yeah, that was Michael Brown. Or
right.
Not Brown. I'm having a brain fart.
Yeah, I'll tell you in a second.
Yeah, do that.
Well, continue talking.
Well, maybe I can't right now.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Because I'm looking for stuff to talk about, too. I'm sorry, guys.
Yeah, we were expecting
3 hours on our own. We thought we were having a guest, so.
Yeah. Police officer name was Darren Wilson.
Right.
He is not going to be prosecuted, even though he's already resigned from the police force. He what?
I thought it was Michael Brown. Okay.
Thank you, Mark. Glad you're paying attention, not falling asleep
back
there.
Yeah, this cold does destroy brain cells, so I will.
You don't have
much
left to destroy, do you?
Brain cells, yes.
Sorry, folks. So, anyway, spring training's going on. San Francisco Giants are in Scottsdale, Arizona, doing their thing, getting ready for the season. They've lost a couple of players this year through free agency.
Think anybody really cares about that?
Yeah, I think, yeah. Actually, I do. Yesterday? Yesterday. Look at, we were waiting for our doctor. How many people, both male and female, were wearing San Francisco Giant hats?
Yeah, that's true.
You know?
A lot of Giants fans
up here.
There
are a lot of Giants up here.
A lot of A's fans, too, though.
Yeah, I like the A's.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but... anyhow, so they lost Pablo Sandoval to Boston, of all places. Oh, my God. Why would anyone want to go play for the Boston Red Sox? I just don't get it.
It's too damn cold. They have 40 feet of piled up snow there. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, so anyway, so. What's coming up this week? Do we have anything?
Oh, let's talk a little bit about who Thomas Jefferson was. I just found that New York Times
article.
Yeah,
you can do that.
There's a biography that was written about him that kind of exposes him. Jefferson was always deeply committed to slavery and even more deeply hostile to the welfare of black slaves or free. He also fathered a couple of children through his slave ownership as well. And there's also, when he wrote in the Declaration of Independence, announcing the self-evident truth that all men are created equal, he owned 175 slaves. And that's kind of like not really good. And while many of his contemporaries, including George Washington, actually freed their slaves, Jefferson did not. And over a period of 50 years, Jefferson remained the master of Monticello and a buyer and seller of human beings. So this is who they want to name the state of Jefferson after. He was not a kind master. He sometimes punished slaves by selling them away from their families and friends, a retaliation that was incomprehensibly cruel even at the time. A proponent of humane criminal codes for whites, he advocated harsh, almost barbaric punishments for slaves and free blacks. Known for expansive views of citizenship, he proposed legislation to make emancipated blacks outlaws in America, the land of their birth. Opposed to the idea of royal or noble blood, he proposed expelling from Virginia the children of white women and black men. But he could have a child with a black woman, and that's okay. See, this is the kind of mentality that I'm afraid we're going to bring into the state of Jefferson.
Well, I think it's obvious that's what they did.
Because they're emulating him. Jefferson also dodged opportunities to undermine slavery or promote racial equality. As a state legislator, he blocked consideration of a law that might have eventually ended slavery in the state. As president, he acquired the Louisiana Territory, but did nothing to stop the spread of slavery into that vast empire of liberty. Jefferson told his neighbor, Edward Coles, not to emancipate his own slaves, because free blacks were pests in society who were as incapable as children of taking care of themselves. Wow. And while he wrote a friend that he sold slaves only as punishment or to unite families, he sold at least 85 humans in a 10-year period to raise cash to buy wine, art, and other luxury goods. Destroying families didn't bother Jefferson because he believed blacks lacked basic human emotions. Their griefs are transient, he wrote, and their love lacked a tender, delicate mixture of sentiment and sensation. Oh, really? This guy was so full of himself. Jefferson claimed he had never seen an elementary trait or painting of sculpture or poetry among blacks, and argued that blacks' ability to reason was much inferior to whites. While in imagination they are dull, tasteless, and anonymous, he conceded that blacks were brave, but this was because of a want of forethought, which prevents their seeing a danger till it be present. Really. A scientist, Jefferson nevertheless speculated that blackness might come from the color of the blood and concluded that blacks were inferior to whites in the endowments of body and mind. Jefferson did worry about the future of slavery, but not out of moral qualms. After reading about the slave revolts in Haiti, Jefferson wrote to a friend that if something is not done and done soon, we shall be the murderers of our own children. But he never said what that something should be. In 1820, Jefferson was shocked by the heated arguments over slavery during the debate over the Missouri Compromise. He believed that by opposing the spread of slavery in the West, the children of the Revolution were about to perpetrate an act of suicide on themselves and of treason against the hopes of the world. If there was treason against the hopes of the world, it was perpetrated by the founding generation, which failed to place the nation on the road to liberty for all. No one bore a greater responsibility for that failure than the master of Monticello. Pretty sad, pretty sad.
Yeah, well, yeah.
This was written by Paul Finkelman, a visiting professor in legal history at Duke Law School. He's a professor at Albany Law School and the author of Slavery and the Founders, Race and Liberty in the Age of Jefferson. Yeah, that's a great person for us to model our new state over.
Well, doesn't that kind of go with the flow of the people who are representing us here?
Well, that's what I'm saying. It fits perfectly in their mentality. You know, I was told when I first came here that there is the reason that the mentality here is different than, say, Mendocino is because after the Civil War, the Northerners settled in Mendocino and the Southerners settled in Lake County. And this is why we see in the long-term ingrained families this almost Southern attitude towards the people around them, including people of color. Rumors are there's a branch of the KKK here. Rumors are that people here are racist. They just don't let anybody know it. And, you know, until I see the evidence, I'm not going to say that's true. But there is an underlying energy here that's very similar to what you'd find in the Old South. And I've been in the Old South, so I know.
Really?
Yes. Yeah. Very sad.
Okay.
So. Slavery mentality.
You know, instead of just rambling on and possibly boring or losing interest of our listeners, we'll just put some music on and we can say our goodbyes after the music.
Yeah, and just call it early today.
Yeah, we know we got a lot to do today personally, so. And since our guest didn't show up, we can just kind of cut loose a little bit, play some
good
music, and then say goodbye.
Sounds
right. How's that sound, folks?
I'm sure they won't mind.
No, I don't think so.
What do you think, Flash?
Flash doesn't think.
Flashy Dashy. He's so happy.
He is. I'd love to see him like that because at home he has competition.
He was a little worried when he got here, but now I think he's fine.
Yeah, but he has competition at home with a little
kitty cat.
Think he
would ride in with us every day?
Huh?
Think he would ride in with us every day?
He could, as long as we're cognizant.
As long as you don't knock him over and make his nose bleed like you did today.
Oh, don't blame me. Come on.
Poor kid.
I know. Look at that eyes.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. Get some music.
Okay, so let me find some music for you guys.
So, folks.
And we'll fill up the hour with some hopefully good music that's going to make you smile.
As usual, we appreciate you tuning in. One way or another, we will be live next week, no matter what it takes. And we'll just go from there. We have some new programming coming on board once we figure out our live stream again. And we do have some announcements to make once we can confirm everything's in place to move forward. So I think
we might be doing a new live show out of the Amiro Brothers.
Right.
That will be on Friday nights, and we will be live broadcasting the music that they'll be performing up
right
there. So, okay, so this is ready. little blues number for you. It's called Just Live Your Life by Otis Taylor.
Sounds good. So.
All right. Whoops. That doesn't sound good.
No. She's spinning her records there, folks, even though they're CDs.
All right.
There we go.
Again.
All right.
Okay, folks, we'll see you next week. Thanks so much for tuning in and putting up with our rants and raves today, and we'll talk to you soon.
And if you have any comments about our rants and raves, you can send your comments to Lake County Magazine. Just go on the site and click on your commentary. And
well, it's better when there's a story for them to comment
to. Okay. Well, then you
but
can
if you want to send us an email, you can catch us at editor@lakecomagazine.com.
Right. Love to hear from you guys.
All right. Here it is. Have a great week, folks. We'll see you next week.
All right.
Jamaica. America. 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 How many roads we had to walk just to make it to their door, only to be told we were too late. How many picket lines we crossed just to get back off the floor, then we fall back in the same old game. But it made me realize, to see the line and train, the shadows of the hand that always pulled the strings. For those who understand, the beginning see the end, guess who is rising again? Me again, knocking on your door, till all your walls come tumbling down. Me again, like Jericho before, Babylon walls come tumbling down, 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 down. Whoa, walls tumbling down. Election promises have failed, those who spoke up have been jailed, yet we go about pretend we don't see. As I walk through shanty towns, gutters choked with broken dreams, hear the trickle down, don't come so far. But it made me recognize, they go to every lane, bend every wheel, till they can get all the way. But this time around, they cannot push us around. Guess who is rising? On your door, till all your walls come tumbling down. Me again, like Jericho before, Babylon walls come tumbling down, 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 down. Whoa, walls tumbling down. Some people say that I am weak, cause I turn the other cheek, only to be disappointed again. What kind of future waits the weak in a world so full with greed? Those with most are those who have to gain. But it made me understand, to see the line and trend of the shadows of the hand that always pulls the string. For those who understand,